I wish I could say morning glory, America, but I really can't. I went to bed knowing it would be bad on Monday morning. I didn't know how bad. Last night, there was just a video of a car running through a parade in Wisconsin, and I didn't realize that five people would be dead and more than 40 people would be injured when I turned on, began to do the morning brief at 4:50 this morning. From the Washington Post, updated last night at 8 p.m., five people were killed and more than 40 were injured after a driver in an SUV plowed through a Christmas parade in Waukesha, Wisconsin, Sunday evening. Waukesha, Wisconsin, Sunday evening. The number of those dead and injured could increase as more information is gathered, the Waukesha Police Department said early Monday morning. Authorities have recovered the driver's vehicle and have taken one person into custody, Waukesha Police Chief Dan Thomas said at a news conference Sunday night. Waukesha Fire Chief Stephen Howard said first responders activated their mass casualty protocols and took 23 people to hospitals, including 12 children. You can stop and pray right there. That's just awful. It's 9/11 in its ferocity at one place. Not 3,000 people dead, but when you hear 12 children taken to the hospital because somebody drove a car through a Christmas parade, I just don't think it gets much worse than this. The vehicle broke through the barricades around 4:40 p.m., which would be, I believe, 5:40 on the East Coast and 2:40 on the West, roughly 40 minutes after the parade began. In interviews, witnesses recounted the terrifying scene after the vehicle barreled into the crowd, shattering the festive mood at the annual Christmas parade in Waukesha, about 20 miles west of Milwaukee. I looked up Waukesha on Wikipedia yesterday, advertising the best of both worlds, the city and the rural life, the suburban, it's just a perfect little town. Waukesha Mayor Sean Riley participated in the parade, described a jubilant atmosphere that quickly turned nightmarish. Today we experienced a horrible, senseless tragedy. He said, I walked in the parade at the beginning. I saw all the happy children sitting on the curb. I saw all the happy parents behind their children. I can still see the smiling faces. In a video of the parade streamed by the city on its Facebook page, the SUV is seen speeding down the parade route seconds after a marching band playing Jingle Bells had passed. Onlookers screamed at the sight of the vehicle barreling down Main Street, whizzing past a Jeep that outfitted in Christmas lights as a police officer chased the SUV on foot. After the parade carried on a few minutes, the emergency vehicle sped by, sirens and lights blaring as a group of children dancing with snowflake props tried to carry on with their performance. A police officer fired at the SUV in an attempt to stop it, said Thompson, the police chief. No bystanders were injured by the gunfire. Carly Sterrell, an intern at the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel newspaper, attended the parade with her family, who took their spots next to parents and children with candy bags and blankets. It was supposed to be an exciting event, Starall 20 said in an interview with the Post. A bunch of little kids were here. People were there to get in the holiday season. Minutes later, the SUV shot past Starall and her family, and they watched it rammed into participants. She counted four people injured on the pavement in front of her. All around her, people were screaming and crying as they rushed to the stores for shelter and tried to help those injured. Everyone was just watching the parade go by and having a good time, Sterrell said. I didn't think anyone expected anything like this to happen. That's exactly true. If you're watching on the Salem News Channel download right now, you'll see the carnage of a parade. It's like a bad, horrible, nightmarish scene. Because everybody is there with cameras. There's going to be more video of this than anyone ever needs to see, except to know that their lives are blessed by not being there. And everybody, you've got, again, if you haven't got the Salem News Channel, you won't have all that we've collected, but you can go and download it. There are, hundreds of people there and little children doing the snowflake stuff and dancing around, and one little girl is dancing on the sideway when this crazed killer goes by, and Dad gets her out of the way and looks back, and off it goes. Now, the Milwaukee Dancing Grannies, which describes itself as a group of grannies that meets once a week to practice dance routine for parades, said its members were also injured. Quote, please keep the grannies, all those injured and all those who witnessed this horrible event, in your thoughts and prayers. School was canceled for today, of course. Just play that tape again, Ben, so that people can see it. If they, you can go running around for it and look, and you'll see the marching bands again. I don't think anything will ever be this videotaped, and it's pretty tough to watch. You don't want your the saxophone players, the local high school band, it's cold, and this driver just doesn't care. There's a stunned band member watching. That we will see more than we can possibly see. There's nothing more to say about this other than I hope you will pray. The identity of the suspect has been released on Twitter. I haven't seen it on a major news channel yet. Dwayne can send me a major news release and I'll read it when I see it in a major news outlet. I am not going to make the mistake of naming the wrong person on the air. But I do want you to think of the thousands of phone calls that were made last night. Because, grandparents and parents who were not there. I think of military moms and dads who are deployed who were not there. I think of aunts and uncles and brothers and sisters and loved ones and people who didn't go. It's just one of those things where if you've ever, and if you get to be my age at 65, you've had a lot of phone calls in your life. That's why I laugh at people who are young and reporting with furrowed eyebrows on stuff and who are solemn in their pronouncements. And I know the Archbishop is listening right now. I know he's already in prayer, actually. The one guy I know who's always listening in the morning is Archbishop Chaput, who's a buddy of mine. And I know that he's gone to prayer, and a lot of people will. And I normally begin Monday with Victory Monday for the Buckeyes and Victory Monday for the Browns, and I could do that today, but this is just awful. So awful, and violence is awful everywhere, but it's almost horrifically so. It has nothing to do with the trial and the verdict and the shootings. It has nothing to do with that, as far as we know, and I don't think that's going to change. There's a narrative that has it tied to another crime and a getaway, which makes sense to me, but we'll wait for authorities, and not going to name anybody. All I know is that there are thousands of people impacted because you do a geometric progression from 40 injured and 5 dead, but people who don't ever unsee it, or a town that doesn't come back, and 12 children, when I say 12 children are at the hospital in critical condition. So what do you do with that? You take it in prayer, and you reflect on it, and you thank God and your lucky stars that it's not you, and you pray for those it is. You know, one thing you can do, we're beginning today our prison fellowship annual drive for children whose moms and dads are in prison. And this might be counterintuitive because someone's going to go to jail for this forever, if not the death penalty. I don't know the Wisconsin law. It's an intentional murder. It's premeditated. You intend to drive down the street. You're not lying in wait, but when you start mowing down people, that's about as premeditated as it gets. We had one of these things happen in Santa Monica, and I thought at first last night, I wonder if an old person got confused and drove into the street, because that happened in Santa Monica. No, that's not it. This is an intentional, I'm going to get away from somewhere, and I don't care how many people I have to kill, or marching bands I have to drive through, or dancing grannies I have to mow down. And so the anger in my voice is mixed with the pity of that. But this is the day that I begin a week early so I can get ahead of Gallagher. Angel Tree asking you to support a child whose mom or dad is in jail. So it might be counterintuitive. But those children are not guilty. Those children are as innocent as these children. So the only thing you can do with tragedy is do an act of kindness in response. So I'd encourage you to go over to HughHewitt.com and donate. That's the only thing, or any other. Go to your church and make a donation. Find a homeless person. The only thing you can do in the face of senseless tragedy. And I have two stacks of stuff, by the way. I have a very short stack of good news and a huge stack of bad news. Because I went off Twitter after the Rittenhouse verdict. I said, I don't need this. And I got back on for two other things. I tweeted out, because I'd never seen a perfect half of football before, and the Ohio State Buckeyes played a perfect half of football. And I pointed that out to people. And then I got on when the Chinese hypersonic news broke last night that it's even bad. It's worse than we thought. So I'll cover all that today. But then this comes along and you say to yourself, I'm glad I live in America. I'm glad I'm free. I'm glad I can pray to my God. But my goodness, there's a lot of evil and tragedy in the world. Redeem the day. Go in and buy some joy for a child who doesn't have much joy in their life. Over at HughHewitt.com, the Angel Tree banner is at the top. That's about the only recommendation I can make. I'll bring you updates. I'll bring you the rest of the news after this. Don't go anywhere, America. It's Monday of Thanksgiving week, and it's a horrible Black Monday to start a week of rejoicing, and we will on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com. 30 years have passed since Justice Clarence Thomas was confirmed to the U.S. Supreme Court. His tenure there has been consequential indeed. He's the court's foremost proponent of natural law, an understanding that our individual rights are transcendent and come from God. This understanding undergirds his approach to the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution, powerfully informing the justices' unyielding commitment to limited government and equal justice before the law. Over the last 5 years, Justice Thomas has authored more opinions than any of his colleagues on the Supreme Court. His influence only continues to grow. And he's beloved by the scores of people who know him. He knows the names of the children of the marshals who guard the courthouse. He's mentored generations of clerks, treating them like family. And his distinctive, hearty laugh rings out within his judicial chambers. May God bless this great, good, and brilliant man. And may he serve on the court many years longer.
Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
But as I said, had they not acquitted him in this vile prosecution from a vile prosecutor, it would have ended, to a very large extent, the whole notion of self-defense in the United States of America. The service this jury performed cannot be overstated. Absolutely cannot be overstated. Yes, you can shoot people who are out to shoot you. This is about as elementary a moral ideal as exists in the human race. And that's what this young man did.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
Budget office contradicted Biden by saying that the spending bill adds $367 billion to the deficit, but they hope to get that $367 billion back from tax cheats. Okay. All right. Good luck with that. Hope there's a lot of cheaters, because that's a lot of money to recover as you're adding to the deficit, as you promised us that it wouldn't add to the deficit. Oh, don't tell me they lied to us again, huh? No, say it isn't so. You mean if you like your doctor, you don't get to keep your doctor? Really? You mean they'll have to pass the bill before we know what's in it? Well, we know what's in it.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
This is a story of how a million children were placed with local foster families through an unlikely alliance between the Chinese government and a British footballer. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans. With unprecedented access across the country, this is a unique insight into the lives of the 90s orphans now driving the 21st century's fastest growing economy.
This story needs to be told across the world. At a time where there's so much negativity and cynicism, here's proof that a single leap of faith can change the world.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow. They don't receive this kind of money. and migrants who enter the U.S. legally certainly don't get this kind of payout. The really big jackpot, it seems, is being reserved for the lawbreakers. There are some obvious truths here. First, behavior that's subsidized gets repeated. Joe Biden is effectively inviting many more illegal immigrants to breach America's open borders. Second, he's betting over time the payoffs will benefit his party in political terms. Meanwhile, the vast majority of Americans watch in shock and dismay as our president, the country's chief law enforcement officer, brazenly rewards lawbreaking, a clear violation of his oath to defend our nation's laws. It's a sorry sight indeed.
Welcome back, America. It's very hard to believe that, isn't it? On a terrible morning, I do. Every life has got a lot of suffering in it, but when you get a Christmas parade invaded by an evildoer, George W. Bush's famous phrase, an evildoer, and dozens of children are involved, and I don't know who's dead. There are at least five people dead and 40 are injured. I just was reading the New York Times rundown, and like the Washington Post, they're not naming anyone. So I don't have any suspect for you, and it doesn't really matter, does it? It's just the children involved and the parents. Hours later, the Times conclude, along the parade route, resting against the entrance to the steaming cup coffee house, three lawn chairs were illuminated by flashing red and blue police lights. Two of the chairs, one pink, the other blue, were child-sized. It's a parade. It's a parade. And so it's almost incomprehensible what happened. It's a bad movie. And you know, every car chase movie you've ever seen, the bystanders miraculously avoid the car, right? Every George Clooney movie you've ever seen, every Vegas heist, every Italian Job, every Steve McQueen getaway, the bystanders are not mowed down. That is not the case here. So I would simply ask you to pray for everybody involved in this. I don't know if there's going to be a GoFundMe page. I'll tell you about that. I don't know what you do other than kindness towards strangers, which is to me the do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with your God. Do justice, fine, try, fairly try, and convict or not convict whoever's involved. Love kindness and walk humbly with your Lord. I heard that from the pulpit yesterday. Great, great sermon. And I was stunned because our pastor had to fly off and do a funeral somewhere and came back. And he preached on a prophecy of Daniel about the Ancient One and the Son of Man. Not because we're not an end times. And my gosh, we're Presbyterians. That's the last thing in the world we are. But it's the... It's about lifting your eyes up from awful things. And he had no idea this was going to happen, obviously. It's 5 hours before, but it was appropriate. When you lift your eyes up from awful things and you contemplate great things and glory, the only response is, you know, this is a veil of tears, and this is a very awful morning. And how do you redeem a veil of tears in an awful morning? You, with grim determination at first and eventually joy, go through the day. And you expand the number of people around your Thanksgiving table, and you do more good, and you do more justice, and you love more kindness, and you act expeditiously towards everyone who you otherwise might be angry with. And you drain the vitriol out of, I mean, if you really are touched, you might be Scrooge, right? You might not be touched by this and horrified by this. And if that's you, I can pray for you, too. There's not much I can do for you. Life has been hard on you if that's how you figure it out. But if you are not that person and you are moved and touched by the awfulness of this, do some kindness. That's Micah 6, right? Everybody knows Micah 6. Dwayne knows Micah 6. Is that right? Am I presuming? I think you know Micah 6. What does the Lord God require of you but to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with your God? And so go over and love some kindness. HughHewitt.com. make a child's Christmas better. A child who has one or both parents in jail. That's immediately right there in front of you. How do you redeem the morning? Because otherwise, you can sit there and think about it and talk to your neighbor and talk to your spouse and talk to your kids about it. I mean, you're going to have to talk to some smalls about it. I'm thinking about my daughter and my grandkids, and, you know, small children see things, hear things. They're all very young. And they're coming this way, right? The scholar and the Artful Dodger and Genghis Kate are headed this way. Genghis Kate is the two-year-old. They're headed this way. And the scholar and the Artful Dodger and Genghis Kate, I will love to be with them. And I'm thinking of grandparents who will not be with children because they will either be gone or will be badly injured in a hospital in Wisconsin. So I am blessed, and so are you, because you weren't there. But do something for someone to redeem that. I'll be right back on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com. Sometimes there are policies so destructive that at first you don't believe they're true. Joe Biden is currently defending one, his plan to award $450,000 to migrants separated from their families after entering the U.S. illegally. Children of deceased U.S. soldiers are separated from their parents permanently. They don't receive this kind of money. And migrants who enter the U.S. legally certainly don't.
Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
Well, I understand the difference between a law and a mandate. So when I got off the airplane and I'm heading to the exit, I took the mask off. And so a gentleman that was in the Dunkin' Donuts line started yelling and screaming at me and referring to me as an idiot. And so I went and asked him, "Why? You know, did you just call me an idiot?" And the bottom line is this, Larry. I remember when you were there on the campaign trail, mm-hmm. and a white leftist came up with a gorilla mask on,
right.
and started yelling at you and throwing eggs at you. I am sick and tired of the left believing that they can coerce, intimidate, threaten, and fearmonger us into compliance. You just talked about the compliance aspect of the LAPD saying, just give people your stuff and don't try to defend yourself. Mm-hmm. I'm not down for that. And so if you want to verbally assault me or verbally accost me, you know, I served 22 years in the United States Army, 3 trips in the combat zones. I'm going to ask you, you know, are you having a bad day? And that's exactly what I did. And so this guy tells me to put a mask back on. And, yes, I pulled his mask down off of his face, and I guess he got upset at that. But I told him, see, nothing happened. And I gave him back his mask. He raised his fist like he wanted to strike me, and I just walked away, you know, pretty much so laughing because this guy was not intimidating or threatening to me whatsoever. But I think the point that conservatives must realize that we cannot allow ourselves to be bullied anymore. You think about you back in 2020, you had 3 Trump supporters who were shot and killed, one in Portland, Oregon, one in Denver, Colorado, a black man in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. We've seen what has happened at these restaurants and some other places. There in San Jose, California, you had Trump supporters that were pelted with eggs and other things and expletives hurled at them. It's time for us to stand up and let the left know that we're not going to be pushed around. We will stand on the rule of law and the Constitution.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
Seminary?
Madre, padre, ¿quién está listo para ser transformado por el poder de su palabra?
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Schools are lining up to push the transgender agenda on kids and cut parents out of the equation.
Go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
what is he charged with? First-degree murder?
That's right, two counts.
How is that possible? It's an altercation. I mean, first-degree murder is where you're like, I'm going to murder this person and go to their home with, you know, not some sort of bar fight gone wrong.
Yeah, so you're right, actually. That would be what you're talking about would potentially be either voluntary manslaughter.
Yeah, that's what I never understood about this.
Or second-degree murder because it was more indiscriminate. What they're saying is, what the prosecution's argument is that Kyle Rittenhouse brought his gun because he intended to murder these BLM protesters and that he had a vengeful intent. Now, what's interesting to me is that the prosecution just a few minutes ago before I came on the show just rested in this case after about a week and a half of testimony. They did not present a single shred of evidence that Kyle Rittenhouse showed up with intent to hurt anyone.
Well, but this is what I can't understand, is that the judge, the pretrial, arguments, because this is just, you have months to submit.
Where he was being held on a psychiatric hold.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt inside the Beltway Live on this Monday. I usually love Thanksgiving week because it is the week that we're a little bit silly on the show. I launched my Angel Tree Prison Fellowship, and I did that. I got ready for it yesterday. Dwayne and I talked to Gallagher every year. It's like moving a stone, getting Gallagher to open that wallet.
I mean, provision. Are you seeking money from in it?
Many thousands are in want of common necessaries. Hundreds of thousands are in want of common comforts.
Are there no prisons?
Plenty of prisons.
The workhouses, are they still in operation?
They are. I wish I could say they were not.
The treadmill, the poorhouses, still in full vigor?
All very busy, sir.
I was afraid from what you said that something had stopped them in full force.
A few of us are endeavoring to raise a fund to buy the poor some meat and drink and food and warmth.
What can we put you down for, sir?
Nothing. You wish to be anonymous?
I wish to be left alone. Since you asked me what I wish, gentlemen, that is my answer.
So Gallagher is always tough, right? That's what he said to us. I said, hey, Mike, Angel Tree, it's time. And that's what he said to us. But you don't have to be that way. Now, I'm going to do the news with the tragedy in the backdrop. You go over to HughHewitt.com. Fetching Mrs. Hewitt and I talked about it, made our gift, as we do every year, because I just think about children at Christmas with nothing, and I think that is the worst thing on a Christmas morning, to come down and mom and dad are already in jail, one or both of them. That's who prison fellowships take care of through the Angel Tree program, children whose mom or dad are in jail. And the children are innocent. They are, they're small, they're young, and all of their friends are at school getting, they're back at school, presumably, getting presents, getting excited, and there is nothing there. Angel Tree takes care of that because of you. Thank you in advance for being generous. Don't be Gallagher. Be like the Fetching Mrs. Hewitt always says, do more. Do more. Because we actually don't need a thing. Right? We don't need a thing. We need, the only thing I have to do is limp up to the grocery store because she forgot something. But, that's just my job all week, is go to the grocery store to get what is forgotten in the preparation. And that is, when I'm off the air, you'll see me at the supermarket or going back and forth to the supermarket. That's my job this week, and that's a great job. And as I said, we are expecting the imminent arrival of the Scholar and the Artful Dodger and Genghis Kate. And Genghis Kate is 2 years old. I don't know if you've done Thanksgiving in a few years with a two-year-old in a small, there will be, I think, 17 people around the tables in a relatively small area. Everybody who has either had COVID, like Genghis Kate, too young for a vaccine, or vaccinated and hadn't had it, that would be us with a booster, we'll all be there and there won't be a mask in sight and we will have fun. But I got to go through the news. I'm going to do the good news first, all right? Because the good news doesn't take very long this morning. Sudan's military and the civilian leaders reached a deal to reinstate the prime minister deposed in a coup. That's good news, right? America's Catholic schools are seeing a surprising rise in enrollment. Despite empty pews, the article says, the number of people turning to the Catholic schools, which stayed open throughout the closure by the public school teacher union-run schools for a year and a half, Catholic schools, but that's good news. Catholic schools are up. A teenager in Great Britain found a hoard of bronze axes. Yes, out there with one of those metal detectors. That's good. You can tell I'm running out of good news, right? And that's it. Those are my three stories in the good news department. The bad news department, you already know about the carnage in Wisconsin. I've told you about that. Keep praying for those people. As we speak, there are doctors, I'm sure doctors and nurses have flooded Waukesha hospitals. I'm sure that Milwaukee's finest are securing everything that they can. I'm sure the Bureau is there. I've seen reports on the suspect, but I don't know it for sure, and so you can go look it for yourself. I'm not going to name anyone until I am 100% mortal lock certain. Like the Browns were a mortal lock over the Lions yesterday. Because we do have Nick Chubb. Baker Mayfield was playing with one working limb. Just a moment, just a comment to you Browns fans out there who are yelling at Baker. Most of you people, you're like Dwayne. You take the day off with a hangnail. And I'll tell you right now, that Baker wasn't very good yesterday, but he was really good in one department, being tough. The NFL, not easy. And he played every down, every offensive down. He's got one working limb, as far as I can tell. There's one thing, his passing arm wasn't working very well because the other three matter, and he got beat up a little bit more. And he didn't do the press conference, and so the people are complaining online about Baker doing the press conference. They were complaining about that before the nightmare in Wisconsin. So they shut up then because they realized, really, we're worried about a quarterback who won, who played with grit. And I know Justin Herbert set every record in the world yesterday, but I'd rather have Baker Mayfield because the NFL is a tough place to play. I'd rather have C.J. Stroud if you're a college player because that was a perfect performance. I watched yesterday Stephen Means and Nathan Baird and Doug LaMaurice do an after game from Saturday. I found it yesterday watching. I call it Browns porn and Ohio State porn. That's what I watch on Saturday and Sunday. And I found the three of them after at the shoe on the field afterwards. You know, these guys work hard. They're there all night long because there's an endless amount of content necessary to satisfy Ohio State and Browns fans. And they're trying to grade C.J. Stroud, who was 27 for 29. And six touchdowns in the first half. 17 straight completions in Ohio State. You know, Ohio State's been playing football for a long time. A long time. And they're struggling. Doug LaMaurice, who's a little bit like me when it comes to broadcasting, his attention wanders. And Nathan Baird and Stephen Means said, there is no grade. I don't have a grade. Get me the Heisman. Because actually, I've never seen anything like it. And Doug says he would stare left, knowing that he has three first-round receivers on the team and a Trevon Henderson first-round running back whose backup is an NFL running back. They had so much talent on that club, it's not even fair. They're going to run into the Georgia defense eventually, and we'll find out. But the Heisman went to C.J. Stroud yesterday, and he'd look left, count 1,001, 1,002, 1,003. Then he'd turn and throw this perfect strike to Garrett Wilson or Chris Olave. They got 10 receivers. They got Earth, Wind, and Fire. That's the new thing. And so I was watching that, thinking to myself, that was perfection. That was fun. I was going to talk about that all day. And then I come in and I got bad news I already told you the rest of the bad news. Let me start with the rest of the bad news. I told you the bad news in Wisconsin. As hopes for nuclear deal fade, Iran rebuilds and risks grow. Iran's going to get the bomb. But that's nothing. Nothing compared to this. Chinese hypersonic weapons fired missile over South China Sea. Pentagon scientists were caught off guard. I told you about that last month. But Dmitry Sevastopoulou updated it. Technology, they have no idea how it works. No idea. It's nothing that we've ever seen. He got more out of his sources, obviously. Because the hyperglide goes up into space, and then it sends out another five missiles on five times the speed of sound going in different directions, guidable. Just think about that. It's like a Dr. Doom weapon in the Fantastic Four wedding issue. You send up a launch, a fleet of these things that can then launch multiple numbers of nuclear weapons that are drone enabled. You can just guide them around. Like if you had a drone up in the backyard and you were good at it, unlike Twain, and you can drive them around at anywhere you want them to go, all of a sudden your carrier, every surface ship is a target in 5 minutes. You have no idea. The only thing you can do is count on the boomers. And you people wonder why in 2016 I kept asking people about the Ohio-class successor, now called the Columbia-class. Because the only thing that survives that, the only deterrent, is underwater or in the air and moving. But even then, it can't move fast enough. It just can't. You've got to be under the water. It's all about the submarines to deter a nuclear-enabled China. It's all about the submarine. Now, it doesn't mean the carriers are irrelevant. The carriers are going to be around for every other kind of conflict and humanitarian aid and to stop any kind of conventional war, and maybe China doesn't want to blow up the world. I don't know, Xi Jinping, is he stable or is he like the guy in the SUV? You tell me. He's ruthless. Okay, they disappeared a tennis star and then the heat was too much because they were going to have the Olympics. People should not go near China. Nobody should go near China. This is like going to play the games. It's as though the Berlin 36 games were held in 44, and we know about Auschwitz. All right, we know about everything that Xi Jinping is allowing to happen in his country. No one should go there. No one should broadcast it. No one should sponsor it, period. You're going to look back, really, NBC, in 50 years when the Uyghurs are gone, erased from the face of the earth, if the regime crumbles, cracks, and falls apart, as every totalitarian regime does, and we're going to find out what they did, and you sent your team there to do happy talk from Beijing in the middle of a genocide, I'm not through my bad news. Across Europe, protests swell as pandemic restrictions rise. So I asked Generalissimo and Adam this morning, I'm going to ask you, has anybody at all, and I'm not just talking about pollsters, but you can count them, has anybody at all in your life with authority, you know, a city councilman, a mayor, a state representative, a congressperson, a senator, the president of the United States, an employer, has anybody asked you what you think about pandemic restrictions 2 years into this? Has anybody asked your opinion? Because they've got riots all over Europe, a lot of them violent, against the reimposition of lockdowns. And I say to myself, that we are a free people. We are innately, Declaration of Independence time. We have natural rights. Those natural rights are bestowed by God. And while governments can do what is, we are not China. We do not weld people into their apartments. And so after 2 years, you have to let people make their own choices. And you know what? You can be safe right now. You can get vaccinated and get the booster like I have and like the Fetching Mrs. Hewitt has and like everybody I know has. Or you can be unsafe for reasons that are your business. But to lock down countries after 2 years, of course people are going to do this. I do not applaud it. I do not encourage it. But it is as predictable as night follows day. The people are going to have it because nobody asked them. Nobody has asked anybody in America. You get the. I saw the Sunday shows yesterday. I saw the guest rundown and I said, not again. Really? Dr. Fauci again? He needs to retire. Now, let me tell you about ReliefFactor.com. All right, they're a sponsor of the show. and I take it every day, and because I'm going back and forth to the supermarket on Thanksgiving, relieffactor.com cannot heal the soul, cannot heal the people who are wounded and dead in Wisconsin, cannot do anything except help you go back and forth to the supermarket without pain. Our Karen Kirkman Resveratrol Omega. Stone cold coffee, because I've been busy working here. Stone cold coffee, but relieffactor.com. Necessary, useful, important. To the holidays, which we are going to get through one way or the other, because we're going to pray for the people who are dead and hurting in Wisconsin and around the world, and for children in hospitals everywhere, and for people locked away and lonely, but we're going to go do stuff for them, and you're going to have to be pain-free to do it. You're going to need your relieffactor.com. Get rid of the aches and pains, because they multiply during the holiday season. Get relieffactor.com. Come right back to the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
Well, I do know him, and inflation is high in other countries, but the main issue is that with the right policies, we don't need to have inflation right now. The quotes that he, the remarks that he made makes it sound like, well, you know, gee, if we just didn't have these supply chain problems, everything would be fine. We wouldn't have inflation. Mm-hmm. Well, that's not really true. The problem with inflation is a matter of too many dollars chasing too few goods. We get too many dollars when the Federal Reserve doesn't do its job. And right now we have a situation where the Federal Reserve is not doing its job. It's created way too much liquidity. There's way too many dollars in the economy.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
Is the beast ever going to act like they're fair? Are they, you know, we'd be treated to a 24/7 barrage of condemnation if Donald Trump referred to Satchel Paige as a Negro. In May of 2016, Barack Obama signed a law banning the use of the word from the federal government. In 2013, the Census Department banned the word. We don't say Negro. And if you slip when you're a Democrat mush brain president, you get all kinds of cover from the media. Now, if you're a sportscaster and you say something on air that sounds like the N-word, your career is finished. You're over.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
The Democratic Party somehow has convinced black people that they're the good guys, never mind the skanky history of the Democratic Party. That was a party of slavery.
He said, listen, I gotta give these niggas enough. Not too much, but enough that I'll have them voting Democrat for the next 200 years.
The race grievance industry would have you believe that blacks get up and think about nothing else except race.
If I tell you this is racist, yeah. I would get you emotional.
There is a whole big cottage industry for racism. If racism went away, a lot of people would be unemployed.
The mob during the Minneapolis riots following the death of George Floyd. A bunch of white thugs, frankly, burning down the city's traditional black and Asian business district.
They're racist, 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 racist. Everything's racist.
It's the devil!
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
How a million children were placed with local foster families. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans.
Go to
Welcome back, America. It's Monday. That means I'm joined by Salena Zito. She's a columnist for the New York Post, the Washington Examiner, and many other places. And Salena, this morning I was going to talk about your column, but now I just want to ask you, what do you do about something like Wisconsin? I really have no words for it.
It really is incredibly tragic. I was in Waukesha not that long ago, like 3 months ago, and had dinner. It's a suburb of Milwaukee, and I had fish fry at a supper club and was just, you know, just like the nicest people in the world, very sort of sleepy little exurb. When you see news like that, it's just gutting, you know, because you immediately project, right? The first victims they talk about are children and older people. And you project, you think about your children, your grandchildren, your parents. And it really hits home because it's happening just, you know, literally on Main Street in America. And it's hard to comprehend why anyone would do anything like this purposely. And so you have that emotion. And then, you know, if you make the unfortunate decision to go on social media and to look for the news, you can't help but be confronted with the immediate reaction by people who just want to turn everything into something political. And it's really disturbing to see how much people just want to promote hate.
Now, Twitter is cancer.
Yeah.
Twitter is online cancer. And, you know, I took a 72-hour, almost complete break from it after the Rittenhouse verdict, because I just didn't want to bathe in filth. Yeah. And both sides now, and three side, four side, I mean, just an endless amount of sort of online depravity. I just said, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to watch football. But, and I haven't spent much time on Twitter this morning except to post an appeal for Angel Tree and to quote the New York Times piece about the little blue chair and the little pink chair at the parade. But you're absolutely right. I merely thought of the, there's a parade over in Old Town Alexandria every year. It's the Scottish Day Parade. It's like the worst parade in America. Yeah. And it is the worst parade in America, but it's wonderful. You know, like they've got Westies and they've got bagpipers and whoever shows up, right? It's like in Pasadena, that crazy parade. There are parades all over, and the kids love them. Little children love parade, and people throw candy to little children. And I'm just thinking, I usually take the Scholar, the Artful Dodger, and Genghis Kate, my three grandkids, whenever I can to anything like this. Can you imagine?
I just took my grandchildren to a parade. So, you know, but as I said, you project, you think, oh my God, what would I have done had that been in front of me? Would I have been intuitive enough to know to pull them back? When I go to a parade again, do I think about something like this?
Of course you do.
Parades are joyful. Parades are joyful experiences. They are the epitome of community gatherings because not only are the people attending it, your neighbors, your friends, there's 3-4 degree separation of just about everyone that's at the parade. The same goes for the people who are participating in the parade. They work forever to in the high school bands to perfect their march down the main street. This means a lot to them to be seen by their parents, their grandparents, and their classmates. We have veterans that walk in parades and all kinds of
the dancing grannies. It is sort of the best thing of America to have the dancing grannies. And marching bands, by the way. I make fun of marching bands. Okay, I love marching bands. Dwayne is a bandy, right? He just directed traffic for 5 million band kids. And band kids are great, and band parents are great, and dancing grannies and little kids. And by the way, don't put on your racial glasses. Don't put on any glasses at all. It's just human beings having some joy.
Incredibly joyful. I was a majorette in high school, in a city high school in Pittsburgh.
You should never have told me that, Selena. You should never have told me that. Wait a minute, Selena. Wait, stop. All right, stop. Wait a minute. Can you still do that thing?
I can still do that thing.
You can?
I just taught my granddaughter how to spin the baton.
You did? Do we have a video of that we can play?
No.
Well, come on. Send us the Selena Meredith. Can you do the way up in the air thing?
No.
Could you, at your height of your majorette-ness, could you do it?
I was a low-level majorette.
Oh, come on. You're being very, very humble here. You could do the big thing, right? The Ohio State marching band guy, you could do that, right?
No, not at all.
Salena is a majorette.
Or major wreck. As I think I put that in my high school
yearbook. No, you back. You didn't. Did you really?
I did.
Major wrecks. Oh, Salena. Wait. What year? What high school? What yearbook?
High School Commodores, 1977.
Perry High School Commodores, 1977. If you have that yearbook, I want that picture. I want that picture. I want that picture. Hey, Salena, have a wonderful Thanksgiving. You made me laugh on a grim morning. Happy Thanksgiving to you. Go back and bake. Majorette, Salena. Oh, I'm laughing now. That's good. Because you've got to laugh. If you, otherwise, you'll cry. I'll be right back. America, it's Hugh Hewitt.
Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
What are some of the things that folks can do? I get that question all the time, and now I have Ben Carson as my guest. Dr. Carson, what can some folks do out there, and what are some of the things that you're working on?
Most important things are not to be silent, not to stand in the corner with your head down and hope that somebody doesn't call you a nasty name or try to cancel you, because you can't be the land of the free if you're not also the home of the brave. So when we had a wonderful example last week in Virginia, as people actually stood up, Democrats, Republicans, Independents, they all stood up and said, you know, we're in charge. You're not in charge, government. You work for us. We don't work for you. This is what people have to begin to do. If they don't do it, the government will take complete control of all of our lives.
Well, it's interesting because it seems to me that things have gotten so extremely bad that many people who would ordinarily keep sleeping are waking up. So that is the good news, that there are people that just never dreamt that we could have gas prices soaring, grocery prices soaring, literally millions of people coming across our borders. Well, yeah. for sure, supply chain problems, weakness around the world, losing many, many billions of dollars of military equipment to our enemies, just levels of horror that I think almost nobody could have believed would happen this quickly.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today at rumble.com. Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
And I'm going to be talking about this tonight on the Laura Ingraham Show. You know about the Kenosha matter with Kyle Rittenhouse being tried right now for the murder of two people? Well, the reason there were protests is because of the false narrative that Jacob Blake, the one who was shot and then put in, ultimately paralyzed from the waist down, that he was unarmed. His father said he was unarmed. He wasn't unarmed. He had a knife. He even acknowledged he did, dropped it, and then picked it up again. How many of these things start with a fake narrative? Michael Brown had his hands up. He was running away. Got shot in the back. No, he was running towards the officer. His DNA was found on the officer's gun, for Christ's sake. Honestly. And as I was saying to Curtis Sliwa, studies have shown for decades that if anything, the police are more hesitant, more reluctant to pull the trigger on a black suspect than a white suspect. And when I said that to these black pastors, they went absolutely nuts. And I said to them, isn't this good news? Isn't it good news that the police are not using deadly force against black people just because they're black? Isn't that good news? Even Mark Lamont Hill, he's a professor, never saw a race card he didn't pick up. In an interview, he conceded that studies have shown that the police are not using deadly force against black people just because they're black. Even he conceded it. And I said that to these pastors, and they just went nuts. began attacking me. I said far and away the number one problem in the black community is the number of kids who enter the world without a father married to the mother. They didn't want to hear it.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
God, our emotions powerful. Whew. They're so powerful. And so many people believe that their emotions are leading them properly and correctly. How do you feel about it? Remember that, we live in the age of feelings. I have lamented that all of my life. We live in the age of feelings. I've been saying that since I began speaking. The age of feelings, people do not know themselves. They know their feelings. Knowing your feelings is not to know yourself. It's to know your feelings. And it's certainly not to be directed properly. How do you feel about it, right? Isn't that something asked to kids all the time? So how do you feel about that? What's troubling you? That was my famous story when my older son was about two in a park in L.A. His mom saw it. I didn't, but she reported it. So some kid like 4 or 5 years old walked over and just threw my son, our son, down. Truly an awful act. His mother came running to him and he goes, "What's troubling you, dear? What's troubling you?" I think the kid should have been given a good whack and punished severely. But I am in a minority. Raising good people ain't easy. Raising happy people ain't easy. They are often, by the way, related, good and happy.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
The most powerful organs of the state are not merely corrupt, but that they've been weaponized to go after perceived domestic enemies. And that's very scary.
Our constitutional democracy enshrines the peaceful transfer of power.
We are now all rooting for his success. The peaceful transition of power is one of the hallmarks of our democracy.
We don't live in the United States of America as any of us would like to understand it.
We have a peaceful transition of power process. That's not what happened.
They interviewed General Flynn, and they did it in what was a complete ambush.
I thought, it's early enough. Let's just send a couple guys over.
And the audience was, ha, 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 ha. How funny to set up an innocent man.
This is what third world security states do. They spy on their political opponents like this.
This is part of a concerted Russian influence operation.
Russian interference.
They colluded. They were in on it.
He would constantly say, I have seen evidence of collusion.
Until this is released, I can't comment.
I can't go into the particulars.
Russians, I'm not going to be specific.
He knew he could just say it on TV and then hide behind, well, it's all classified, I can't get into it.
Well, it's classified, you can't see it.
Collusion, you just got to be willing to see it.
New York's Daily News ran this front page, Trump is Hitler.
How could 62 million Americans vote for Hitler? Are 62 million Americans Nazis?
We really almost thought it was a joke. Like, really, you're not going to accept that you lost this election?
Then they see the Russia collusion narrative sitting right there in front of them and say, why don't we just say that he cheated?
It divided the country in ways that people can't imagine. It's inspired massive violence. It's given people who are bad faith actors a license to do whatever they want because they literally feel like they're fighting Russian spies and Nazis.
Russiagate has been the most egregious abuse of everything that was supposed to have been good about our government.
Morning, Glory America. Bonjour. Hi, Canada. It's Monday of Thanksgiving week, and that means the family is headed towards grandmother's. Yes, I have covered extensively, if you're just tuning in, the tragedy in Wisconsin. I am joined now by Jake Sherman of Punchbowl News. Jake, of course, a wonderful young parent, at Jake Sherman on Twitter, at Punchbowl News. And Punchbowl News this morning, he's covering Inside the Beltway. He doesn't cover stuff like Wisconsin, but I will nevertheless ask him about it. Good morning, Jake. How are you?
I'm okay, Hugh. And by the way, we did link to a story about this, but we didn't. But as you know, we try to stay in our lane, and if we, you know, if it doesn't cross over into our very, very niche coverage area, we try to just stick to that, despite the horrible tragedy in Waukesha.
I got to ask you about it, though, as a young parent. Have you gotten into the parade years yet? As I recall, you're not in parade years yet, which is ages three and up.
Well, we are. My son is four, so.
And my okay, daughter, now you are into the parade years.
Yeah, we are, but we don't. I guess, you know, since we live in D.C., there aren't a ton of parades. I mean, there are, but we haven't gone to a ton of parades. Although I was just talking with my parents, who were in town last night, about how my son would love the New York City Thanksgiving parade because he loves, you know, those characters. So maybe we will maybe we'll watch it on TV on Thursday.
Well, over in if you drive across the river to Alexandria, Virginia, they have the Scottish parade, right? And that is definitely a sea parade. It's a great deal of fun. I love it. I've gone to it many, many times. But it's bagpipes and Westies and open cars, and John Warner would be in it until he passed away. He was always the Grand Marshal, and it's just what happened. It was what the setting was. It's Main Street. It's for kids. That's all it is, for marching bands and kids and dancing grannies. I think it will shock America throughout the week. I think it's going to have some repercussion. I don't think it will have anything to do with Congress. I think Congress is split, right? They're out of town.
Congress is out of town until after Thanksgiving, yep.
So what is the deal? I'm going to have a column up at the Washington Post shortly on Nancy Pelosi's $200 million for the Presidio Park. What is the deal with that, Jake? How in the world does someone justify $200 million for your neighborhood park?
Well, it is a very nice park, but you're right. I actually have not completely seen how in the text it direct the money to the Presidio Park, whether it makes the Presidio Park eligible for the funds, or, you know, as you know, Hugh, but many people don't know, sometimes in the era of no earmarks, sometimes language is written that only makes one entity eligible. Like, it says for parks that include X, Y, and Z and are of a certain size. But yeah, I mean, listen, this is the power of being a congressional leader, right? I mean, we saw Hal Rogers used to do this when he was the appropriations chair, used to shuffle lots of money to Kentucky, and Shelby, Richard Shelby of Alabama, does the same thing for Alabama. But you're absolutely right. It's something that people are outraged about.
You know, there is a tendency to figure out how to communicate the breadth and depth of pork. Feel like the Bridge to Nowhere, Ted Stevens, like Ted Stevens' Bridge to Nowhere. The $200 million for the Presidio Park is going to be in 1,000 ads. Because I've been to the Presidio, it's beautiful. It was given to the Presidio Governing Board in 1996, I believe, 25 years ago, with the intention in the original statute that if it wasn't self-sustaining, it would be turned over to the General Services Administration, like the Pennsylvania Avenue Redevelopment Corporation turned over everything on Pennsylvania Avenue to the GSA this year, I think. And instead it gets $200 million, and she lives, what, 10 blocks away? Isn't there a limit, Jake?
San Francisco's a small city, so I think most things... But yeah, no, I believe she lives in that neighborhood. All that said, you're absolutely right. I mean, this is something that people... And you see Chuck Schumer has touted some of the money that he's bringing back for the New York subway system and things of that nature. And on the political aspect... We already see the Congressional Leadership Fund or American Action Network, I can't remember which one, but one of the House Republican outside groups is already running ads on this. So your prediction that it'll be in ads is not even really a prediction as much as it is a current reality.
Oh, is the Presidio, my column may or may not be up. I don't know if it's up already. I wrote it on Friday. It goes up on Monday. saying this will be in 1,000 ads. There is no way, it's malpractice for you to run for Congress and not mention that Nancy Pelosi gave her neighborhood park $200 million. Isn't that malpractice?
It is, we're already seeing it. So you're absolutely right. We're already seeing that this is becoming a political issue, that House Republicans are trying to make it a political issue. And I think that it will resonate, to be honest with you, because here's the thing. If you are a persuadable voter, meaning if you are not voting for, definitely voting for a Republican or definitely voting for a Democrat, people don't like pork, right? People just don't like the smell of it, so to speak, and they don't like the vibe that it gives of the government, which is largely seen as we see this in polls right now. Excuse me. It's largely seen as spending too much money.
Well, way too much money, but $200 million for a park. People, you got to scale this down. They don't really understand, nor would I understand, what the SALT deduction is and why it goes to rich people, unless you have spent a lot of time understanding state and local income tax, property tax deduction. But they get parks, and they get $200 million, don't they?
Yeah, but I think that's true. That's very tangible. Although, if you wanted to make SALT a political issue, you are able to, right? You could say that this helps out coastal elites. I mean, that's
it helps me. Even though it helps me,
it helps me too. It helps.
I own a house in California and Virginia. I'm the person that got gouged by the Republicans, and I'm the person that's going to win under the Democrats. What are they thinking?
Well, Republicans got rid of this in the 2017 tax bill, and it was, by the way, remember, and you know this because you are a Californian at heart, and although you're not a Californian by birth, but you are a Californian at heart, the SALT deduction did screw over a bunch of Republicans, House Republicans, who voted for it and did not.
Amy Walters is in retirement today because of that.
Yes, and I remember very well McCarthy told House Republicans from California they needed to vote for the bill. Many of them did. I mean, look at Valadeo; he lost after voting for it. And that's not a very extremely wealthy district. But the state and local tax deduction is a big issue. I mean, this just shows the patchwork nature of our tax system, I would say. And I think it's something that here's the reality, Hugh. I hate to say this, they couldn't pass this bill without taking care of SALT, and they won't be able to pass it through the House and the Senate once again without some sort of provision to take care of SALT.
Well, I would like to thank Nancy Pelosi and Chuck Schumer. They just made my property tax bills in Virginia and California deductible again, and that what people don't understand is I call it the working wealthy. If people are working and they have to work and they have a house in one of these rich districts, they pay a lot of property taxes. And the Republicans took away the ability to deduct that, and the Democrats are giving it back. Bravo, Democrats, because people make a deal. They buy houses usually with a 30-year time frame, and they invest, and that's how you build wealth in America. I warned McCarthy. I would argue with Kevin, head of Ways and Means, Texas.
Brady.
Kevin Brady. I would argue with Kevin Brady. Kevin, don't do this. This is not fair. And they did it anyway because people in low real estate states figure, we're not going to subsidize California, New York. But to put it back, are the Democrats suicidal? They're going to get wiped out.
Yeah, well, here's the other thing, Hugh. I would argue that if you this is not only for the working wealthy. I mean, there is a case to be made that you can make with a straight face that middle class residents of a state like New Jersey or New York, where you're paying massive property tax in places in Westchester, which is wealthy, but not all of Westchester is wealthy, and you're paying $50,000 a year in property tax or $30,000 a year in property tax, or the people want that to be deductible, and they're not people who are making $1 million a year. So, I think that this is a complicated issue that is not completely cut and dry. I, that's all I would say.
All I would say is, Jake, there are ways to limit this to hit that person who's making $200,000 or less a year, and they can do an income test. You get this if your line 14A is below $200,000, your adjusted gross income is below $200,000, you get to deduct. I mean, you can do that. They didn't do that. They just gave it away.
But there is talk now in the Senate among people like not Bernie Sanders, but also Bob Menendez, that they need to put some guardrails on this. And I think there's a wide recognition that they're going to do that.
How about Nancy Pelosi's park? Are they going to take that away from her?
That we'll see. I don't think so.
We'll see. Jake Sherman, I think you're going to see a lot more retirements, as you predict, in today's Punchbowl News after Thanksgiving. Follow Punchbowl News at Punchbowl News. Go get the morning newsletter. It's free. Follow Jake Sherman at Jake Sherman. Thank you, Jake. Happy Thanksgiving. I'll be right back, America, on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
The most powerful organs of the state are not merely corrupt, but that they've been weaponized to go after perceived domestic enemies. And that's very scary.
Our constitutional democracy enshrines the peaceful transfer of power.
We are now all rooting for his success. The peaceful transition of power is one of the hallmarks of our democracy.
We don't live in the United States of America as any of us would like to understand it.
We have a peaceful transition of power process. That's not what happened.
They interviewed General Flynn, and they did it in what was a complete ambush.
I thought it's early enough. Let's just send a couple guys over.
And the audience was, ha, 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 ha. How funny to set up an innocent man.
This is what third world security states do. They spy on their political opponents like this.
This is part of a concerted Russian influence operation.
Russian interference.
They colluded. They were in on it.
He would constantly say, I have seen evidence of collusion.
Until this is released, I can't comment.
I can't go into the particulars.
Russians, I'm not going to be specific.
He knew he could just say it on TV and then hide behind, well, it's all classified, I can't get into it.
Well, it's classified, you can't see it.
Collusion, you just got to be willing to see it.
New York's Daily News ran this front page, Trump is Hitler.
How could 62 million Americans vote for Hitler? Are 62 million Americans Nazis?
We really almost thought it was a joke. Like, really, you're not going to accept that you lost this election?
Then they see the Russia collusion narrative sitting right there in front of them and say, why don't we just say that he cheated?
It divided the country in ways that people can't imagine. It's inspired massive violence. It's given people who are bad faith actors a license to do whatever they want because they literally feel like they're fighting Russian spies and Nazis.
Russiagate has been the most egregious abuse of everything that was supposed to have been good about our government.
The thing that they were investigating the Trump campaign for is what they themselves were doing.
I think we're witnessing freedom making a massive comeback in America. It feels like Americans are opening their eyes to a freedom-loving country more than I've ever witnessed in my life. And there's a lot of people that are coming from all sides who just make a lot of sense. I mean, the Biden administration is in such bad shape. The person they want to be the comptroller of the Treasury is a woman who wants to upend the banking industry, wants to nationalize the banking industry. She wants to end banking as we know it. Her words. Now, I saw Senator Tim Scott make a little speech about this woman that the Biden administration once confirmed as a top-ranking Treasury Department official. And he just seems like he's in a state of shock. The left is trying to defend this doomed nominee, and she better be doomed. You cannot have somebody in charge of the purse strings who wants to blow up the banking industry. and wants to nationalize, wants to federalize banking. Yeah, that's just what I want, the government calling all the shots with my checking account. They're nuts. I mean, they're purposefully picking people who are so radical and bizarre.
Keep up with what's trending.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, Monday Inside the Beltway on a Thanksgiving week where many of you are just jarred awake this morning by the awful tragedy. It's not a tragedy, it's a crime. It's a horrific crime in Waukesha where at least five are dead, dozens are hospitalized after an individual driving an SUV mowed into a parade. There is no name released officially by police. I'm not going to name anyone. I'm not going to speculate. It's all over the web if you want to go and find. But remember, the web is often wrong. Just wait a while, you'll learn. But in the meantime, if you can turn sorrow to good or bad use. You can go out and become a vigilante. Don't do that. You can become a kind person and try and add light and happiness in the world. Do that. I have over at HughHewitt.com the Angel Tree appeal. My annual appeal during Thanksgiving and Christmas to remember the children of people in prison. And that's what Prison Fellowship does. Listen to one mom, Cecilia, talk about what it means.
I would have never, ever, ever in my life imagined, you know, because of COVID, that my kids, when I walked in, they were going to be screaming and crying. That's from my daddy. My daddy sent me a present. I was like, I mean, instantly, you know, I couldn't stop crying. And Prison Fellowship, they hold a very near and dear space in my heart.
They do, and they do this every year. Don't be like Gallagher. All right, now, Dwayne and I went up to Gallagher on Friday and asked him, would he please support Angel Tree?
Provision. Are you seeking money from me then?
Many thousands are in want of common necessaries. Hundreds of thousands are in want of common comforts.
Are there no prisons?
Plenty of prisons.
The workhouses, they're still in operation?
They are. I wish I could say they were not.
The treadmill, the poorhouses, still in full vigor?
All very busy, sir.
I was afraid from what you said that something had stopped them in full force.
A few of us are endeavoring to raise a fund to buy the poor some meat and drink and food and warmth.
Oh, what can we put you down for, sir? Nothing.
You wish to be anonymous?
I wish to be left alone. Since you ask me what I wish, gentlemen, that is my answer.
So we're going to work on Gallagher. We are. But in the meantime, head over to Angel Tree at HughHewitt.com. Go to the top. There, the ghost of Hugh, present, past, and future, is going to descend on Gallagher and get him into the Thanksgiving and Christmas spirit before long. I love George C. Scott as Scrooge, by the way, I really do. I've been talking for a long time about Job Creators Network, and now they are about blocking federal mandates on private businesses, small businesses. Blockthemandate.com. All across, you heard me in the first hour report on the European convulsions. All across Europe. The people are revolting. Not all people, but some people are revolting. And said, not again. We've had 2 years of lockdown, 2 years of mandate. There are vaccines everywhere. You told us it would be over. In fact, everyone who wants to be safe from the vaccine can be safe from the vaccine. I mean, safe from the virus can be safe from the virus by getting the vaccination and the booster. But you can't make people do things that they don't want to do unless you're going to be an authoritarian. If you're going to be an authoritarian in a free state, forget it. It's not going to work. If you can't persuade people, fire your persuaders. Don't hire enforcers. If Tony Fauci cannot get people to get the vaccination, fire Fauci. Don't bring down the authorities on non-persuadables. They're running a risk. They are running a risk, but you can protect yourself and your children. You can protect yourself. There is no more reason for a mandate ever. Ever. Now, if an employer says get mandated, you have a choice to make. They have the legal authority to do so. If a state tells you to do so, the federal government doesn't. Job Creators has said blockthemandate.com. Go and join them at blockthemandate.com. Let me check on the price of gold, if you don't mind. Birch Gold is the sponsor of the show, and every morning I try and tell you what gold is doing at the pre-market opening. And gold is, of course, where you go when inflation comes. I read a story over the weekend that raised my eyebrows, saying that we are systematically understating inflation. And I was persuaded by that after I read this analysis provided to me by Robert O'Brien. Head over to HughGold.com or text my name, Hugh, to 474747. Gold this morning is at $1,842 an ounce. That's down a little bit from Friday. 1842 an ounce, but at HughGold.com. If you're going to buy anything for someone this Christmas and you can afford that, buy them some gold at Birch Gold. You can trust Birch Gold, HughGold.com, or text my name, Hugh, to 474747. Coming up next, the Attorney General of Ohio, David Yost, joins me, and we won't just talk Buckeyes and Browns. Stay tuned.
This is Carol Platt-Lebow for townhall.com. 30 years have passed since Justice Clarence Thomas was confirmed to the U.S. Supreme Court. His tenure there has been consequential indeed. He's the court's foremost proponent of natural law, an understanding that our individual rights are transcendent and come from God. This understanding undergirds his approach to the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution, powerfully informing the justices' unyielding commitment to limited government and equal justice before the law. Over the last 5 years, Justice Thomas has authored more opinions than any of his colleagues on the Supreme Court. His influence only continues to grow. And he's beloved by the scores of people who know him. He knows the names of the children of the marshals who guard the courthouse. He's mentored generations of clerks, treating them like family. And his distinctive, hearty laugh rings out within his judicial chambers. May God bless this great, good, and brilliant man. And may he serve on the court many years longer.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
Are you at all thinking about some relief on any of your mandates?
Listen, there's mandate fatigue everywhere, including with yours truly, so let there be no doubt about that. At the moment, no.
This guy is a scumbag. He is awful. Contrast that with Governor DeSantis, America's greatest governor, most courageous, and just announced his reelection campaign to become governor of Florida again, a well-deserved campaign of a man who has been overly courageous with now the lowest COVID rates in the country. Can you get if it's COVID rate, death rates, or virus rates? It's whatever it is. It's the lowest in the country. Pursuing alternative treatments like monoclonal antibodies. The first major state to reopen. Phenomenal economic figures. No mask mandates for children, and in the school districts that are doing that, DeSantis is clamping down. He banned critical race theory, and DeSantis has done this in a logical and reasonable way. I'm inspired by his leadership versus the weak Vichy French Republicans across the country that continually pander to Pfizer, AstraZeneca, Moderna, Johnson & Johnson. Ron DeSantis has been terrific. But Ron DeSantis understands the promise of the Constitution, unlike Murphy and most Republicans in the country, where Ron DeSantis says, a year and a half ago, we started with 15 days to slow the spread. Now it's get jabbed or lose your job. You see, what Ron DeSantis recognizes is that the sovereign is the people, not him. It's not we, the Ron DeSantis, or we, the governor of Florida. No, it's the people's rights that come first.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube. Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
I've just heard so much about this, and nobody seems to be taking it seriously.
This is the exact reason that in normal science, this is not normal science by any stretch of the imagination, we do benefit risk analysis. And obviously that is different for each person. But here we're not doing that. We're just saying everybody needs to do this. And we're completely neglecting natural immunity, which is extremely important. We've recognized it for decades and decades before now. Now they won't even want to talk about it or acknowledge it at all.
What do you reckon is behind that? I mean, this is a big thing. What can be behind something like that?
Well, I can't think of any scientific valid reason for doing it. You know, there could be political reasons or other things going on, but I can't think of any scientific reason why you would ignore the evidence and the facts and just push a one-size-fits-all ideology.
We also know that many people have objections to these vaccines because all three of them, in one way or the other, involved aborted children. There's no getting around that. And so if somebody has an objection to that, how is it that the government can wipe away religious liberty and say, you've got to get this. If you want to keep your job, you've got to get this.
You know, for the government to mandate away your religious liberty is a real issue. And even the federal court has recognized that and put a stay on the mandate.
almost reduces all the other news to secondary, but it shouldn't. Our tennis star in China, who is being allowed to make a video and smile, and they even, I mean, the ham-handed Chinese authority even put in a Winnie the Pooh picture to show that it was, you know, not coerced, which is like giving it away. This is coerced. I'm happy. Look, do not go near the PRC. This is what they do. And the hypersonic story, which I covered earlier, that is also what they do. Just don't get near it. Let me do tell you to get near relieffactor.com. Fetching Mrs. Hewitt entered an objection saying that I don't go to the store for her nearly enough. But I do. She actually complained of turkey elbow yesterday. Many of you have turkey elbow, right? Turkey elbow is that injury that occurs when you're getting down dishes that you get down once a year. And we're preparing for 17. And I will, of course, be doing most of the cooking. Not at all. I will be doing the dishes, which is my traditional. And I will be wrangling children. I told you that the destroyers are coming. The scholar and the Artful Dodger and Genghis Kate are coming. And Genghis Kate is the two-year-old. And so I'm on alert. I'm trying to put stuff high. I'm trying to get things out of reach. You know, defending against a two-year-old is actually kind of impossible. And so that's my job this week. But the Fetching Mrs. Hewitt is busy wrestling. She got turkey elbow. Many people get turkey elbow. It's a lot like tennis elbow. ReliefFactor.com will work for you. $19.95. Go and take it. Take it every day. Thanksgiving through Christmas and New Year's. That's what you need. I'll be right back on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
But as I said, had they not acquitted him in this vile prosecution from a vile prosecutor, it would have ended to a very large extent the whole notion of self-defense in the United States of America. The service this jury performed cannot be overstated. Absolutely cannot be overstated. Yes, you can shoot people who are out to shoot you. This is about as elementary a moral ideal as exists in the human race. And that's what this young man did.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
Budget office contradicted Biden by saying that the spending bill adds $367 billion to the deficit, but they hope to get that $367 billion back from tax cheats. Okay. All right. Good luck with that. Hope there's a lot of cheaters, because that's a lot of money to recover as you're adding to the deficit, as you promised us that it wouldn't add to the deficit. Oh, don't tell me they lied to us again, huh? No, say it isn't so. You mean if you like your doctor, you don't get to keep your doctor? Really? You mean they'll have to pass the bill before we know what's in it? Well, we know what's in it.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
This is a story of how a million children were placed with local foster families through an unlikely alliance between the Chinese government and a British footballer. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans. With unprecedented access across the country, this is a unique insight into the lives of the 90s orphans now driving the 21st century's fastest growing economy.
This story needs to be told across the world. At a time where there's so much negativity and cynicism, here's proof that a single leap of faith can change the world.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, 1-800-520-1234. Out of Wisconsin, a terrible story. Red SUV plowing through a parade. My phone number is 1-800-520-1234. I'm kind of old-fashioned. The only way to respond to this is to pray for the victims. There may be an effort to assist the victims. I'll tell you about it when it gets organized. I'm playing the video. If you've downloaded the Salem News channel, you will see there will be more video of this than anything ever videotaped because it's a parade. And so everybody is there for one reason, one of two reasons, just to have some fun or to see their child or their dancing granny or their band member. Hey, Generalissimo, come up with me for a second, if you don't mind. You're a band parent, right?
Yeah. Exactly. I've 2 years ago, before the pandemic, we went to San Francisco, and our band marched in the Chinese New Year parade.
Can you imagine? I mean, what?
That's all I've been thinking about. Is it's a band parent's worst nightmare. Is you are at the mercy. I mean, you're going down the middle of a public street, so you are at the mercy of whoever is the line of defense at the tail end of that parade, right?
Traffic control.
Right. You're
at the mercy. And you assume. I mean, it's the one thing you assume in this world.
Which is why I am so, when we did this tournament a couple weeks ago that you gave me such a hard time about.
I didn't give you, I was just pointing out that you're an authoritarian at heart.
You gave me a hard time about that. And remember, that's what I was doing, is I was the line of defense blocking off that parking lot from anybody trying to get in to where those kids and buses were. I took that very seriously because I'm a parent. You know, there's a very small line of defense between a bunch of prone kids and the general public.
And so when you watch this, you know, this is when people start to worry about the next parade. It has never happened to my knowledge at a parade before, has
it? You were right to mention what happened in Santa Monica, but that was a confused elderly driver who mixed up the gas pedal and the brake and ran through a barricade and did not have any awareness of what they shouldn't have been behind the wheel anyway. But
right, and was not convicted, as I recall.
Not convicted because they weren't, you know, non compos mentis, right? You know, they weren't aware of their situations. This is a wholly different matter.
The second thing that I wanted a band parent's perspective on, every band parent films everything, right?
Oh, yeah. I've already seen, I don't know, 5-6 different angles. There's probably going to be 100 different videos.
It's heartbreaking. I'm looking at one right now. If you've got the Salem News channel and you can download it if you want.
The dad with that little girl as the car whizzed by. Oh, yeah. My stars.
He was separated from her.
Yeah.
But the car was between him and the little girl.
Right.
And it's a heart stop. But there are five little girls or little boys and other victims dead and 40 injured.
And a handful of those pediatric cases that are injured, it was banned. It was banned kids.
And this car, what do you think he's moving at?
The one video I saw, he had to be doing every bit of 65, 70 or better. He was booking down a city street. And there's lots of online, I know we're not going to speculate and get into it, but there's lots of online reports that speculate what he may have been doing.
Stop. Yeah, we're not going to go there. All it is
right.
is that think about the victims and think about the fact that they're just normal people. I mean, it's just a normal, it's a parade, it's band parents, it's little kids, it's throwing candy at them, it's open car. I don't even know physically, I just have no idea how anyone could do that. It's, do you remember that the worst movie ever made was the one about driving cross country trying to run over people?
The worst movie ever made?
Death Race 2000 or something like
that? Oh, yeah, that was a pretty bad movie.
Was it Death Race 2000?
I think so, yes.
Okay. And so, the worst movie ever made. And people, no one went to it because the premise was so awful. And this is that. And it's real.
Well, yeah, and every police drama, every movie that you, action movie, there's scenes driving down the sidewalk, all that stuff. I mean, you know, trying to but nobody ever gets hurt in that, right?
Well, that's it. Nobody ever gets hurt until somebody does it for real, and then it's just it's a disaster. I'm trying to think, by the way, we've done explosions. We, of course, did 9/11 for hours and hours and hours. This is in the top 10 of bad news events.
After 9/11, I don't remember exactly when, but wasn't there a jihadi sidewalk driver that ran over a bunch of people in New York somewhere?
In New York, yeah, but it wasn't a parade. It wasn't children.
Right.
It's the children and band and teenagers angle exactly. That makes this just so gut-wrenching. We'll come back and bring you the latest, as breaking news always dominates on the Hugh Hewitt Show. Don't go anywhere, America, except over to HughHewitt.com. If you're just grimly horrified, go to Angel Tree. The banner is at the top of HughHewitt.com. It's what I did this morning. The fetching Mrs. Hewitt. Just redeem the day. Do justice. Love kindness. Do the love kindness stuff. I'll be right back on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Jump on the air.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you by Prison Fellowship's Angel Tree Summer Camps. Click on the banner at HughHewitt.com.
Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
Well, I understand the difference between a law and a mandate. So when I got off the airplane and I'm heading to the exit, I took the mask off. And so a gentleman that was in the Dunkin' Donuts line started yelling and screaming at me and referring to me as an idiot. And so I went and asked him, did you just call me an idiot? And the bottom line is this, Larry. I remember when you were there on the campaign trail, mm-hmm. and a white leftist came up with a gorilla mask on,
right.
and started yelling at you and throwing eggs at you. I am sick and tired of the left believing that they can coerce, intimidate, threaten, and fearmonger us into compliance. You just talked about the compliance aspect of the LAPD saying, just give people your stuff and don't try to defend yourself. Mm-hmm. I'm not down for that. And so if you want to verbally assault me or verbally accost me, you know, I served 22 years in the United States Army, 3 trips into combat zones. I'm going to ask you, are you having a bad day? And that's exactly what I did. And so this guy tells me to put a mask back on. And, yes, I pulled his mask down off of his face, and I guess he got upset at that. But I told him, see, nothing happened. And I gave him back his mask. He raised his fist like he wanted to strike me, and I just walked away, pretty much so laughing because this guy was not intimidating or threatening me whatsoever. But I think the point that conservatives must realize that we cannot allow ourselves to be bullied anymore. You think about you back in 2020, you had 3 Trump supporters who were shot and killed, mm-hmm. one in Portland, Oregon, one in Denver, Colorado, a black man in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. We've seen what has happened at these restaurants and some other places. There in San Jose, California, you had Trump supporters that were pelted with eggs and other things and expletives hurled at them. It's time for us to stand up and let the left know that we're not going to be pushed around. We will stand on the rule of law and the Constitution.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
Seminary?
Madre, padre, ¿quién está listo para ser transformado por el poder de su palabra?
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Schools are lining up to push the transgender agenda on kids and cut parents out of the equation.
Go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
What, is he charged with first-degree murder?
That's right, 2 counts.
How is that possible? It's an altercation. I mean, first-degree murder is where you're like, I'm going to murder this person and go to their home with, not... not some sort of bar fight going wrong.
Yeah, so you're right, actually. That would be what you're talking about would potentially be either voluntary manslaughter.
Yeah, that's what I never understood about this.
Or second-degree murder because it was more indiscriminate. What they're saying is, what the prosecution's argument is that Kyle Rittenhouse brought his gun because he intended to murder these BLM protesters and that he had a vengeful intent. Now, what's interesting to me is that the prosecution just a few minutes ago before I came on the show just rested in this case after about a week and a half of testimony. They did not present a single shred of evidence that Kyle Rittenhouse showed up with intent to hurt anyone.
Well, but this is what I can't understand, is that the judge, the pretrial, arguments, because this is just, you have months to submit, motions to dismiss. You're trying to tell me no one looked at this? They say, wait a second. You're charging a guy who got in an altercation, was, by the way, the guy that Kyle Rittenhouse killed in self-defense was like a child rapist or something, right? He was like a child pedophile or something. Is that right?
Multiple count child rapist. And honestly,
I'm not saying he deserves to die because of it, but
right. Details of those case, if anyone wants to see it, it's absolutely horrific.
This is not Gandhi, okay?
But what's interesting, though, what's actually relevant to this is that he had just been released from a hospital where he was being held on a psychiatric hold.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
Well, I do know him, and inflation is high in other countries, but the main issue is that with the right policies, we don't need to have inflation right now. The quotes that he, the remarks that he made makes it sound like, well, if we just didn't have these supply chain problems, everything would be fine. We wouldn't have inflation. Mm-hmm. Well, that's not really true. The problem with inflation is a matter of too many dollars chasing too few goods. We get too many dollars when the Federal Reserve doesn't do its job. And right now we have a situation where the Federal Reserve is not doing its job. It's created way too much liquidity. There's way too many dollars in the economy.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
Is the beast ever going to act like they're fair? Are they? We'd be treated to a 24/7 barrage of condemnation if Donald Trump referred to Satchel Paige as a Negro. In May of 2016, Barack Obama signed a law banning the use of the word from the federal government. In 2013, the Census Department banned the word. We don't say Negro. And if you slip when you're a Democrat mush-brain president, you get all kinds of cover from the media. Now, if you're a sportscaster and you say something on air that sounds like the N-word, your career is finished. You're over.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
The Democratic Party somehow has convinced black people that they're the good guys. Never mind the skanky history of the Democratic Party. That was a party of slavery.
He said, listen, I gotta give these niggas enough. Not too much, but enough that I'll have them voting Democrat for the next 200 years.
The race grievance industry would have you believe that blacks get up and think about nothing else except race.
If I tell you this is racist, yeah. I would get you emotional.
There is a whole big cottage industry for racism. If racism went away, a lot of people would be unemployed.
The mob during the Minneapolis riots following the death of George Floyd, a bunch of white thugs, frankly, burning down the city's traditional black and Asian business district.
They're racist, 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 racist. Everything's racist.
It's the devil!
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
How a million children were placed with local foster families. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans.
Go to salemnow.com.
morning, Glory America. Bonjour, hi, Ken. They do do it on a dark morning in Wisconsin and across the United States and indeed across the world as people across the globe turn and say, what is wrong with that country? Because I actually don't recall cars running through parades anywhere else. I'm joined by Congressman Ken Buck of the wonderful state of Colorado, who I originally wanted to have on to talk about redistricting, but I'll ask him first. Ken Buck, what's your reaction to this Wisconsin parade? Just horror.
It is horror, and it's terribly sad. I have very little information about the person who committed these crimes. I understand that he's in custody. My guess is he's obviously mentally unstable, and I don't know if there was a further motive than that. We've seen these kinds of acts in France and in other places, but having a number of people dead, just really sad.
Children marching bands, dancing grannies. We've had jihadis before attack using cars, but this is not that, at least according to early reports. It's dumbfounded. I've appealed to people, redeem the moment by going over to HughHewitt.com. Give to Angel Tree. That benefits children. We can't benefit these people, but you can pray for them. Ken, let me go to the story. The reason I originally asked you to come on today, Congressman Buck is, of course, from Colorado. He's running for re-election. They're drawing districts in Colorado. I do not understand what is going on there. I don't understand what's going on in a lot of states where they've adopted hybrid systems. I used to understand redistricting pretty well. It was up to the state legislatures. People gerrymandered everywhere when they could because that's what Americans do. They seek for advantage in politics, and people work it out through politics. But I do not understand what's going on in Colorado. What is going on there?
Well, we passed a constitutional amendment for a new a commission that would redraw the congressional boundaries as well as the state legislative boundaries. The commission met. They had a number of hearings, 30, 40 hearings around the state, gathered information. They had a number of different maps that they voted on. And finally, I think it was the fourth map, maybe even the fifth map that they agreed to and have redistricted the state. What we have now are three safe Republican seats for the most part. I say safe, you could never be too safe, but pretty safe seats. We have three pretty safe Democrat seats. We have one lean Democrat seat and one toss-up seat in Colorado. So we added an eighth congressional district in Colorado this decade as a result of the last census.
So talk to me about who's on this commission. Because I looked at the map. In the Ohio map, they actually kept counties together, and it just seems to me that it made a lot of sense. I don't think this Colorado map makes a lot of sense, does it?
Well, they didn't keep counties together. They kept some political subdivisions like cities and other areas together. But it's interesting. I think that they tried their best to create a competitive seat, and in so doing, they had to pull major urban or major population areas out of counties. And so you're absolutely right. A lot of the counties around Denver, the high population area of Colorado, got split up. And I think it really, in my district, I lost Greeley, Colorado, and sort of one of the population centers so that they could create this eighth district.
Yeah, you know what makes me crazy about this stuff? I understand the arguments are political on both sides. I've always been just let the chips fall if it's a political process. But when you pretend not to be a political process and you end up trying to create a, quote, competitive district, that's actually overclass propaganda. That's, competitive districts are good for the country. No, they're not. Nothing is necessarily good or bad. It's political. It depends on what you believe and who wins, whether or not it's good or bad. But the idea that the overclass says competitive makes sense and therefore we're going to cut Greeley out of Ken Buck. I didn't know that, by the way, until you just told me. That's just stupid reasoning. Don't they ever step back and say we're being stupid?
Well, I don't think they acknowledge that they're stupid, but I can tell you this. What they tried to do in the eighth, the new district, is to create a Hispanic, quote-unquote Hispanic Latino district.
Ken, pause for a minute. That's unconstitutional. You can't use race in the drawing of districts. You can't. It's like the one rule there is.
And so they call it a community of interest, and that's exactly what they do. They did. They have open debates about their intention. But to suggest that the Hispanic or Latino community in Colorado is monolithic is crazy. And to draw a district for a group of people that have very diverse interests, the people who live in rural Colorado, in Greeley and other places in northern Colorado, much different interests, views, values than the people who live right in the Denver area, in Denver itself. So I agree with you that they're, the whole premise of their position on in this map is really faulty.
You know, I like to tell people, the Chief Justice of the United States, people criticize him from left or right, but the one great thing he said in Seattle school districts, I think it's a 2007 case, the way to end discrimination on the basis of race is to stop discriminating on the basis of race. And that is, by the way, what they just did. If they drew a district based upon Latino population, they discriminate on the basis of race. It's unconstitutional as the day is long. Is anybody suing over these maps? Because we end up with judge-written maps for a reason.
Well, there is a group suing, and it turns out to be that Latino group, and are suing. They are suing because it's not discriminatory enough, and it is fairly amusing, and I appreciate your laughter because,
well, it is.
The other groups, the Democrats aren't suing, the Republicans aren't suing. The only group that's suing is a Hispanic group that thinks they didn't get enough Hispanic representation.
Yeah, you know, Ken Bach, you've been at this a long time. You were the Attorney General for a while. So you know your law, and you've been in Congress a while. What year were you elected to Congress?
2014.
And you'll be reelected as long as you want to be reelected. How long are you going to go for, by the way, Congressman? Another decade? Two?
No.
That's what I said about my radio career 20 years ago.
I have no end date in sight, but I certainly hope there are other opportunities for me out there. The more I stay in Congress, the less employable I get. So,
well, that's true. Sure what else I'm gonna but do. You're going to be in the majority, right? I mean, there's no way after the Democrats pass this Do you know that there's $200 million for Nancy Pelosi's park in this bill? You know, the Presidio gets $200 million.
The devil is always in the details with these bills, and it fascinates me. The, you know, the Kennedy Center money that was in the bill back a couple years or a year and a half ago, it's amazing how much they could slide into a 2,000-page bill when they give it to you at the last minute and nobody really has a debate about it. The votes were locked in long before the bill was drafted.
$200 million. What's the closest park to your house, Congressman? Because when you get in the majority, you're going to want $200 million for it, aren't you?
No, I'm not. Actually, I don't want $200 million for a park.
But did it come up? Did anyone? I wrote a column about it. It'll be over at the Post because I'm just so astonished at the brazenness of the speaker. Because the Presidio is a beautiful place. It's surrounded by Pacific Heights. No, they're in the house in Pacific Heights. It's less than $10 million, right? That you get a fixer-upper for $10 million in Pacific Heights. And so the Pacific Heights Neighborhood Park is the Presidio, and they got $200 million after they've gotten millions of dollars over 25 years. There is no limit to their avarice.
Oh, absolutely. And I understand that the speaker now is house hunting in Florida because she wants to be in a Republican state that respects individual choices concerning COVID and other issues. And so I'm afraid that if people from California keep moving into the rest of our states, we're going to be in real trouble.
Well, you know, I haven't heard that yet. But if she goes to Florida for zero income tax and becomes one of the, I'm a tax exile. I live in Virginia now. I just did not want to pay California taxes anymore. And I'm also getting up at the crack of dawn. So Congressman Bach, in terms of what you expect to see, we got less than a minute. The 2022 elections will be a referendum on Nancy Pelosi and Joe Biden. Are you confident the Republicans will get the gavel to Ken to over to Kevin McCarthy come next year, December?
Very little doubt in my mind. I think there's a 99% chance that Republicans win the House. I think it's clear to see from the Democrats who are retiring that it is going to be a Republican majority. The question really is, Hugh, do we do what we need to do and to start to roll back the terrible programs that we have seen in the Build Back Better plan and other spending that the Democrats are engaged in?
The only answer I think makes sense is I hope so. Ken Buck, always a pleasure to talk to you, friend. Be well. Ken Buck, one of the great people of Congress, longtime friend, former Attorney General of Colorado. My KNUS audience knows him well. Don't go anywhere, America. I'll be right back on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
What are some of the things that folks can do? I get that question all the time, and now I have Ben Carson as my guest. Dr. Carson, what can some folks do out there, and what are some of the things that you're working on?
Most important things are not to be silent, not to stand in the corner with your head down and hope that somebody doesn't call you a nasty name or try to cancel you, because you can't be the land of the free if you're not also the home of the brave. So when we had a wonderful example last week in Virginia, as people actually stood up, Democrats, Republicans, independents, they all stood up and said, you know, we're in charge. You're not in charge, government. You work for us. We don't work for you. This is what people have to begin to do. If they don't do it, the government will take complete control of all of our lives.
Well, it's interesting because it seems to me that things have gotten so extremely bad that many people who would ordinarily keep sleeping are waking up. So that is the good news, that there are people that just never dreamt that we could have gas prices soaring, grocery prices soaring, literally millions of people coming across our borders. Well, yeah. for sure, supply chain problems, weakness around the world, losing many, many billions of dollars of military equipment to our enemies, just levels of horror that I think almost nobody could have believed would happen this quickly.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today at rumble.com. Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
And I'm going to be talking about this tonight on the Laura Ingraham Show. You know about the Kenosha matter with Kyle Rittenhouse being tried right now for the murder of two people? Well, the reason there were protests is because of the false narrative that Jacob Blake, the one who was shot and then put in, ultimately paralyzed from the waist down, that he was unarmed. His father said he was unarmed. He wasn't unarmed. He had a knife. He even acknowledged he did, dropped it, and then picked it up again. How many of these things start with a fake narrative? Michael Brown had his hands up. He was running away. Got shot in the back. No, he was running towards the officer. His DNA was found on the officer's gun, for Christ's sake. Honestly. And as I was saying to Curtis Sliwa, studies have shown for decades that if anything, the police are more hesitant, more reluctant to pull the trigger on a black suspect than a white suspect. And when I said that to these black pastors, they went absolutely nuts. And I said to them, isn't this good news? Isn't it good news that the police are not using deadly force against black people just because they're black? Isn't that good news? Even Mark Lamont Hill, he's a professor, never saw a race card he didn't pick up. In an interview, he conceded that studies have shown that the police are not using deadly force against black people just because they're black. Even he conceded it. And I said that to these pastors, and they just went nuts, began attacking me. I said, far and away, the number one problem in the black community is the number of kids who enter the world without a father married to the mother. They didn't want to hear it.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
God, our emotions powerful. Whew. They're so powerful. And so many people believe that their emotions.
Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Welcome back, America. The Washington Post updated this story. I've been reading it to you on the Hugh Hewitt Show since we started broadcasting 2.5 hours ago this morning. Five people were killed. More than 40 were injured after a driver in an SUV plowed through a Christmas parade in Waukesha, Wisconsin on Sunday evening, a violent end to the otherwise festive scene where children were dancing in the street and a marching band played Jingle Bells. The toll of dead and injured could increase as more information is gathered, the Waukesha Police Department said early Monday. Authorities have recovered the driver's vehicle, have taken one person into custody. Waukesha Police Chief Dan Thompson said at a news conference Sunday evening, "The investigation is very fluid. I am not speculating. I know it's all over the place, but I don't do that until someone comes out and talks to us about it and gives us a name. The pictures are horrible. We are playing Salem News Channel coverage of it over at the Salem News Channel app if you've downloaded it. Look, all I can ask you to do is pray for, I mean, if you've got five dead and 40 injured, you're probably more than 50 people, and they all know 100 people in their lives. Just start doing the math of the trauma and start with the most trauma are those who are gone and those who are struggling for their lives, and pray for the doctors and nurses who are caring for them and the EMTs who got them there and the trauma that everyone has suffered. It's just a remarkably horrible thing. And I keep watching the little girl in the pink dancing and her dad grabs her and gets her out of the way. They were one of the lucky ones. Dad was watching when another dad on the other side of the street, He barely missed one toddler. He didn't miss a lot of toddlers, right? We don't know. All I can say is this is the day I usually launch my prison fellowship Thanksgiving and Christmas campaign. And I did launch it over at HughHewitt.com. And the Fetching Mr. Hewitt and I made our donation this morning. And I would ask you to do that as well and pray for these victims and redeem the day a little bit. Do justice, love kindness, walk humbly with your God. Go and love a little kindness on children who don't have parents because they are in prison. Over at HughHewitt.com, that's the prison tree at the top. You'll see the angel tree, prison fellowship banner at the top of HughHewitt.com. Let me check the 10-year interest rate. I have in my hand a story that was sent to me. It's from Maudlin, John Maudlin, on the inflation period that we're in. It's just getting started. Put aside the politicians, the talking heads. Go find any economist, hence the present shortages, hence prices and growing inflation. There is an arbitrary imposition of an interest rate cap right now, and the only thing you actually can afford to buy is a house. I'm the only thing I can tell you there's a good investment is a refinance right now, because the 10-year treasury is at 1.536% this morning. Head over to andrewandtodd.com and tell them you want to buy a real estate investment. You can go to keycitycapital.com/you as well if you want to get involved in apartments. But andrewandtodd.com, great sponsor, so is Key City Capital, this show. And I try and recommend to people that they put their money into investments that in an inflationary period are likely to do. You got to be fully invested. You cannot have money under the mattress because it's going to decline in value every day. People don't remember, unless you're my age or older, 1979, 1978. That's 13.5% interest rates. The prime, 13.5%. And that meant, you know, it came down under Reagan. We bought our first house under Reagan, the Fetching Mrs. Hewitt and I, and we had 12.5%. But if you were trying to buy a house in 1979 and the prime was 13.5%, add 4 points. I don't know anyone who bought a house then. And you know, we went out and we got a house in 1985, a townhouse, because we were having a baby. And so you had to have a little more room, couldn't live in an apartment. So we went out to the burbs and got ourselves a little townhouse. And if you can do that, do it now or buy a rental or something. Go to andrewandtodd.com or call them at 888-1172 because the Fed is holding down interest rates and will hold down interest rates until Jerome Powell is, and if they don't name Jerome Powell, I hope he raises interest rates immediately. This can't go on. This is an arbitrary, fake prime interest rate because inflation is everywhere, but you don't have to live with it if you can go get refinanced right now, andrewandtodd.com, because boy, in a year, it isn't going to be that way. It's just not going to be that way in a year. Stay tuned, America. I'm coming right back. Finally, some good news for Baronelle Stutzman and Kristen Waggoner from Alliance Defending Freedom. It's some good news on a grim day. I'm sure those two ladies are playing for every victim in Wisconsin this morning. I'll talk to them about that more when we come back on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you by Alliance Defending Freedom.
Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
God, our emotions powerful. They're so powerful. And so many people believe that their emotions are leading them properly and correctly. How do you feel about it? Remember that? We live in the age of feelings. I have lamented that all of my life. We live in the age of feelings. I've been saying that since I began speaking. The age of feelings, people do not know themselves. They know their feelings. Knowing your feelings is not to know yourself. It's to know your feelings. And it's certainly not to be directed properly. How do you feel about it, right? Isn't that something asked to kids all the time? So how do you feel about that? What's troubling you? That was my famous story when my older son was about 2 in a park in L.A. His mom saw it, I didn't, but she reported it. So some kid, like 4 or 5 years old, walked over and just threw my son, our son, down. Truly an awful act. His mother came running to him and he goes, "What's troubling you, dear? What's troubling you?" I think the kid should have been given a good whack and punished severely. But I am in a minority. Raising good people ain't easy. Raising happy people ain't easy. They are often, by the way, related, good and happy.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
The most powerful organs of the state are not merely corrupt, but that they've been weaponized to go after perceived domestic enemies. And that's very scary.
Our constitutional democracy enshrines the peaceful transfer of power.
We are now all rooting for his success. The peaceful transition of power is one of the hallmarks of our democracy.
We don't live in the United States of America as any of us would like to understand it.
We have a peaceful transition of power process. That's not what happened.
They interviewed General Flynn, and they did it in what was a complete ambush.
I thought, it's early enough. Let's just send a couple guys over.
And the audience was, ha, 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 ha. How funny to set up an innocent man.
This is what third world security states do. They spy on their political opponents like this.
This is part of a concerted Russian influence operation.
Russian interference.
They colluded. They were in on it.
He would constantly say, I have seen evidence of collusion.
Until this is released, I can't comment.
I can't go into the particulars.
Russians, I'm not going to be specific.
He knew he could just say it on TV and then hide behind, well, it's all classified. I can't get into it.
Well, it's classified. You can't see it.
Collusion. You just got to be willing to see it.
New York's Daily News ran this front page, Trump is Hitler.
How could 62 million Americans vote for Hitler? Are 62 million Americans
Nazis. We really almost thought it was a joke. Like, really, you're not going to accept that you lost this election?
Then they see the Russia collusion narrative sitting right there in front of them and say, why don't we just say that he cheated?
It divided the country in ways that people can't imagine. It's inspired massive violence. It's given people who are bad faith actors a license to do whatever they want because they literally feel like they're fighting Russian spies and Nazis.
Russiagate has been the most egregious abuse of everything that was supposed to have been good about our government.
The thing that they were investigating the Trump campaign for is what they themselves were doing.
The Democratic Party somehow has convinced black people that they're the good guys, never mind the skanky history of the Democratic Party. That was a party of slavery.
There is a whole big cottage industry for racism. If racism went away, a lot of people would be unemployed.
The mob during the Minneapolis riots following the death of George Floyd, a bunch of white thugs, frankly, burning down the city's traditional black and Asian business district.
They're racist, racist, racist. Everything's racist.
Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
How a million children were placed with local foster families. Parents from all walks of life share their stories of overcoming the one-child policy by taking in orphans.
Go to salemnow.com.
Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt inside the Beltway Live. It's a grim morning across America and the world as they look at what happened in Wisconsin, but I have a little bit of good news to add to an otherwise grim morning. I'm joined by Kristen Waggoner and Baronelle Stutzman. You know Baronelle from her long, long, long effort, now over, to defend her religious beliefs by refusing to participate in ceremonies with which she does not agree because of her faith. She's been represented for years by Kristen Waggoner and the Alliance Defends, Alliance Defending Freedom. Good morning, Baronelle. Good morning, Kristen. Good to have you back. Baronelle, you're such a... I'll bet your heart is breaking for the other grandmothers in the world this morning as we look at Wisconsin. You won't be worried about yourself or talking about your case. You'll be worried about these people. I know you.
Absolutely.
And Kristen, same way, right?
Yes, our hearts are troubled, and we're praying for them, praying for the healthcare providers that are serving them in these moments as well.
So with that, I just wanted to acknowledge it so that people know we are, of course, thinking about people like that, but I do want to update them, and perhaps I'll start with you, Kristen. Would you remind us of Baronelle's and the florist shop, the facts, the result, the fact that the court did not do what it ought to have done last year and give her relief, but you finally brought about an end to this case?
Sure. Baronelle served her customer, Rob Ingersoll, for nearly a decade. She designed dozens of arrangements for he and his partner. But when he came in and asked her to design custom arrangements for a same-sex ceremony, she said that was the one event that she couldn't do because of her relationship with Christ. The state of Washington and then the ACLU pursued Baronelle relentlessly through the court system, not just suing her shop, Arlene's Flowers, but actually suing her personally so that it could punish and ruin her, taking nearly all she owns. She needed to choose between her convictions and facing severe financial penalties. The case has a long history. It went up to the U.S. Supreme Court at the same time Masterpiece Cake Shop with Jack Phillips did. The U.S. Supreme Court wiped out the bad Washington decision, sent it back down. The bad Washington decision got put back in place. And then just this last summer, the Supreme Court denied hearing Baronelle's case for a second time. And that left us to where we are today, Hugh, and we were able to reach a settlement. And I can go into that, but I've talked long enough. But it was really a miracle and a gift from God, we believe, that got us into that position to allow Baronelle to retire.
Now, Baronelle, you are able to retire finally and stop this battle. I am still disappointed deeply in the Supreme Court. I understand their law and logic. I understand that they didn't want to hand down too many decisions at once, but they had to avert their eyes from your situation. How do you feel about the courts after this long drama and finally a settlement that allows you to retire and yet the shops stay open?
Well, I'm not retired yet, but I'm getting really close.
And
I'm really disappointed that the courts didn't uphold my constitutional rights. And I hope they see past this because there's many other cases to follow mine. So we're hoping for good from that.
And Kristen, I believe the court, if they ever got to the merits of Baronelle's case, would have upheld her rights. Why do you suppose they didn't ever get to the merits? Did they expect a settlement like this? And is the reason the ACLU settled because they knew the third time and they would be out?
I do think that the ACLU was deeply concerned with where we're at. Just one day before the reconsideration deadline was to expire in Baronelle's case, the 10th Circuit Court of Appeals ruled in a case called 303 Creative, which is a case very similar to Baronelle's, except it's involving website designs and actual words. And Lori Smith is being compelled, under the same law that Jack Phillips is being compelled, to violate her beliefs and to have to express messages that violate her convictions. That case is pending before the U.S. Supreme Court. We're asking the court to hear that case. And it was that decision that allowed us to ask for reconsideration in Baronelle's case and gave leverage to ensure that she doesn't lose all she has, that she can pass her legal torch on to others with a case positioned at the court, and we're optimistic the court will grant cert and resolve this issue.
Now, I want to emphasize the exposure which Baronelle bravely took on over all these years. It would have been very easy to serve Rob. It would have been very easy to give up. How long has this been going on for, Baronelle? When did this start? What year did this begin?
2013.
Okay, so I can't do math, I'm a lawyer, 8 years into this, and Kristen, you know, thank goodness I'm not in retail, Baronelle, or we would be broke immediately. Kristen, how many pages of paper have you filed on behalf of Baronelle?
Oh, thousands of pages of paper, many, many hearings. We fought to ensure she wouldn't be personally liable, and the ACLU fought to ensure she would. Many, many court battles over the 8 years.
And so I know the court they can't proceed on the basis of the suffering or the injustice to one person. They have to look at the big picture. But I know, Baronelle, I've met you often, you two together, you obviously love each other, have great affection for each other. Why do you think this, Kristen, is a victory?
Because my first obligation and ADF's first obligation is always to our clients.
Yep.
We need to do right by them, and the idea that a 77-year-old grandmother could lose everything she owns because she politely served a gay customer for 10 years and didn't do his marriage is just unthinkable. It's something that can't happen. But second, you know, God provided, I believe, an opportunity not only to resolve Baronelle's case, but another opportunity to get these cases before the court. So she's able to retire on her timing. And we are able to continue the cause to affirm the principle that no one should be forced to express a message that violates their convictions. And Baronelle has stood not only for her own beliefs, but even for those of Rob and Kurt, for their freedoms as well, even if they don't realize it.
And Baronelle, I want to take the opportunity to thank you. A lot of people don't do this because they don't want the attention. They don't want the abuse. We hear about threats and we hear about the awful climate in which we live today. You have lived through that. And I know how awful it's been and how many people have tried to turn you into... You're like the least villainous villain that the left has ever come up with. I mean, I can't really make you into a villain. But what is your perspective on this at the end of it?
Well, you know, my faith has never been the decision for the courts or for somebody else. My faith is in God, and it's really pretty simple. I trust that God's plan's better than mine, and my job is just to be faithful for his word. And yes, there has been a cost over these years to stand, but there's a bigger cost if we don't stand.
Let me ask this, Kristen, as a concluding summary here. Is there any restriction at all on Baronelle talking about her faith, her case, did the ACLU get a gag order of any sort on Baronelle?
Absolutely not.
And that allows her to continue to witness and to talk about her case and to encourage others to be strong in their religious liberty. What, no matter what that religion, she happens to be a Protestant like most of my audience is, or a Catholic like most of our audience is. They're just basic Christian, mere Christian. But for any religious believer or no belief at all, Alliance Defense steps up. Any doubt about that, that she's an encourager, Kristen?
Not at all. She's inspired millions of others in their own battles to live their faith out in the public square.
Baronelle, again, thank you. Will the Thanksgiving be different this year? You're not going to have to tell people whether or not the house is going to be sold to pay the judgment?
No, I get to have Thanksgiving with my family, and there's going to be 19, and I hear you're going to have a big family gathering, too. So happy
We have 17. We have 17, but I have a Genghis Kate coming, a two-year-old. Do you have any two-year-olds going to your house?
I do.
You see, that's always the wild card, right?
Absolutely.
Kristen, how about you? Are you going to have a wonderful Thanksgiving?
I am, yes. We're really looking forward to it. All three kids are under one roof, which doesn't happen all that often anymore.
Well, bravo to all of us. We are the lucky ones, and our prayers are for those who are suffering in Wisconsin. Thank you both. Alliance Defending Freedom at work this Thanksgiving, as they are every Thanksgiving, protecting the rights of people like Baronelle because of talent like Kristen Waggoner, her counsel through all these years. I have been inspired all these years. I go to a lot of Alliance Defending Freedom events, the Blackstone Fellows, the annual gathering, whenever I can, and they ask, I go and do it for them because they are amazing. They defend you, they defend me, they defend everyone's rights, and they do it without complaint, and I appreciate it greatly. 1-800-520-1234. 1-800-520-1234. I haven't talked to anyone yet this morning. I don't want any crazy people calling me up in the midst of this sorrow, national, and this tragedy. I do want people to go over to HughHewitt.com and be as generous as possible. I've been looking, I'm kind of astonished over at the running total of gifts at HughHewitt.com at the Angel Tree Prison Fellowship banner at the top. 500, 200, 250, 500, 1,000. People are really digging deep. I think the tragedy in Wisconsin makes them think about children without parents in spite of Gallagher. And we tried. We went to Mike. Dwayne and I approached Mike. We got film of it, in fact, if you're watching on the Salem News Channel. And the part you don't hear, I say, Mike, would you finally give us some money? And
provision. Like Mike. Are you seeking money from it?
Many thousands are in want of common necessaries. Hundreds of thousands are in want of common comforts.
Are there no prisons?
Plenty of prisons.
The workhouses, are they still in operation?
They are. I wish I could say they were not.
The treadmill, the poorhouses, still in full vigor?
All very busy, sir.
I was afraid from what you said that something had stopped them in full force.
A few of us are endeavoring to raise a fund to buy the poor some meat and drink and food and warmth.
Oh, what can we put you down for, sir? Nothing.
You wish to be anonymous?
I wish to be left alone. Since you ask me what I wish, gentlemen, that is my answer.
So, Mike, you've got to change your mind, Mike Gallagher. We will not leave you alone. We'll play this every day. I've got the tape, Mike. I've got the tape. Mark C. in Michigan. Huh? Oh, I said the word! Oh, I'm really off my game this morning. I said the word during game week. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm going to make another contribution because of that. Mark C. in
the
state up north.
What's Macbeth next?
Let's get to a theater and say Macbeth. Oh, my gosh. What did I do? Oh, all right. Mark C. in the state up north gave $200. Timothy R. in Oklahoma gave $100. Robert S. in Virginia gave $500. Darcy in Georgia. I love people named Darcy. Who names their children Darcy? I love that name. Darcy gave $125. God bless you, Darcy. Richard R. in Idaho. In Idaho. Who's awake in Idaho? Gave $200. Thank you all. Mike Gallagher, go and study that list. Because I'll tell you, we got to get Mike into this campaign. I'm not even sure he's participating this year. He just grumbles all the time. You know, I've known Gallagher a long time, but this is, I'm always astonished how we have to drag him into these campaigns to help children. I do, in all sincerity, Mike does a wonderful job at this, as we all do. We love Angel Tree. Every Salem host loves Angel Tree because we know it means so much. Listen, play Cecilia, the mom.
I would have never, ever, ever in my life imagined, you know, because of COVID, that my kids, when I walked in, they were going to be screaming and crying. That's from my daddy. My daddy sent me a present. I was like, I mean, instantly, you know, I couldn't stop crying. And Prison Fellowship, they hold a very near and dear space in my heart.
In the midst of sorrow, in the midst of darkness, add some joy to somebody's life. The banner is at the top of HughHewitt.com. You'll also find ReliefFactor.com over there. Actually, Mrs. Hewitt just sent me a note. You didn't do the shopping today. She's already been. She forgot something. So she's already been to Trader Joe's this morning as the hoarder rides. But she's got Thanksgiving elbow. Thanksgiving elbow is what you get when you reach for plates you get down once a year, or you lift pans that you lift once a year.
Thanksgiving elbow is when you reach for your wallet.
Yeah, well, that's the other thing. But that's not reach for your wallet for Prison Tree, but go to ReliefFactor.com. $19.95. Leave a little bit at every plate, right? Because then people, when they bend over, they'll hurt their back, but give them ReliefFactor.com. Josh Kraushaar is next. Hotline Josh on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you by Prison Fellowship's Angel Tree Summer Camps. Click on the banner at HughHewitt.com.
Tesla was a genius. His most amazing discoveries thought to be written in a lost journal. Now in the right hands, it could revolutionize the 21st century, but in the wrong hands. Kill him. Kill him.
If you can stop an earthquake, doesn't that mean you could start one too?
That's why that notebook should never fall into the wrong hands.
There's an old brown battered notebook in my office at work. You have to find it, take it, and keep it hidden at all costs. The G20 leaders meeting downtown, they're in danger. In fact, the whole of downtown could be in danger.
If we are to build a superhuman, we must first eliminate those who are flawed.
People are created equally. All of downtown, the high-rises were built on rollers to withstand horizontal shakes. A vertical quake this size could collapse half of downtown.
We have commenced the countdown.
Shall we stop this thing?
Save the universe!
Now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
Are you at all thinking about some relief on any of your mandates?
Listen, there's mandate fatigue everywhere, including with yours truly, so let there be no doubt about that. At the moment, no.
This guy is a scumbag. He is awful. Contrast that with Governor DeSantis, America's greatest governor, most courageous, and just announced his re-election campaign to become governor of Florida again. A well-deserved campaign of a man who has been overly courageous with now the lowest COVID rates in the country. Can you get if it's COVID rate, death rates, or virus rates? It's whatever it is. It's the lowest in the country. Pursuing alternative treatments like monoclonal antibodies. One of the first major state to reopen. Phenomenal economic figures. No mask mandates for children, and in the school districts that are doing that, DeSantis is clamping down. He banned critical race theory, and DeSantis has done this in a logical and reasonable way. I'm inspired by his leadership versus the weak Vichy French Republicans across the country that continually pander to Pfizer, AstraZeneca, Moderna, Johnson & Johnson. Ron DeSantis has been terrific. But Ron DeSantis understands the promise of the Constitution, unlike Murphy and most Republicans in the country, where Ron DeSantis says, a year and a half ago, we started with 15 days to slow the spread. Now it's get...
Subscribe on YouTube and at Rumble.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Final segment of today's show. Over at HughHewitt.com, you will find the Angel Tree banner at the top. But at the Washington Post, you will find my new column, Pelosi's Presidio Deal is a Reminder that Power Has Its Perks. I'm joined by Hotline Josh on Twitter, Josh Kraushaar from the National Journal. Josh, Nancy Pelosi tucked into the Build Back Better bill $200 million for her neighborhood park, the Presidio. $200 million for a park that is 10 blocks from her house, if that. What in the world were they thinking when they voted for this? It's like political suicide.
Yeah, I mean, look, that remember the earmark debate in the Republican Party? That kind of behavior, getting perks for your local congressional district, is frankly all too common in Congress. It doesn't surprise me a whole lot. It's probably, when we look at all the details, and it is just the House version of the Build Back Better bill, but is it the infrastructure bill or the Build Back Better bill?
It's Build Back Better.
Okay, it's the Build Back, it's the proposal. But, you know, there's going to be stuff sorted out in the Senate. It's going to be coming back to the House for another vote, so we'll see what stays in it, what gets taken out. But these types of personal perks, you know, which once were seen as sort of a way to lubricate the legislative process, giving, you know, money to certain members of Congress who might not otherwise vote for legislation in their district, you know, it's become seen as corrupt and not a healthy part of the legislative process.
Josh, you've been around a while. You remember the Bridge to Nowhere, Ted Stevens' infamous Bridge to Nowhere, right? It was just pure pork. It actually began the earmark revolt. But that was for the poor people of Alaska who didn't have anything else to do, right? They could fish for salmon, they could go hunt moose, and then they could build a bridge to nowhere. This is the Presidio. $200 million for the Presidio.
Yeah, I mean, I'm actually surprised that it was in the Build Back Better bill, not the infrastructure package, but at least that nominally might have some connection to infrastructure or to parks and whatnot. But yeah, I mean, look, there's a lot. I bet there's going to be a lot more of this type of waste we see. I mean, look, the House version of that bill cost over $2 trillion. I mean, it's not just going to pre-K. It's not just going to climate change. There are a lot of other perks and goodies that are part of the legislation that folks haven't gone over with a fine-tooth comb like you did, Hugh. So, you know, there's going to be a lot more of that kind of stuff in there and ripe for a lot of political opponents of this legislation to say, hey, this is not a useful use of taxpayer funds.
I look for defining features. I was going to write about restoring the salt because that's a gift to me. I own property in both on both coasts. I'm in a house in California that I'm never going to sell that has high property taxes, and now I live in Virginia. So yeah. The salt deduction thing that they worked out, it's just like a gift to Hugh Hewitt. I can't believe it. What were they thinking?
Well, I mean, keep in mind, Hugh, when Trump's tax reform and cuts passed in 2017, the only Republicans to vote against the tax reform, I believe, were in California and New Jersey, New York, right? I mean, the highest tax areas in the country. So all politics still is a little bit local. Obviously, the Democrats in those states, Josh Gottheimer was probably the chief proponent of rolling back or of expanding the deduction again. You know, he's making this as a case for cutting taxes to his constituents. So that's how he actually got on board with voting for the Build Back Better legislation.
I didn't think it's
not good politics, though.
I didn't think it was going to be possible to make the political environment worse for Democrats after redistricting and after all the inflationary impact and after Virginia. But this is all after that. They put $200 million for the Presidio, Nancy Pelosi's park, in the bill, and they gave a tax deduction to millionaires and 10 millionaires and 100 millionaires. So, Josh Kraushaar, I, is there anything in your experience this reckless politically, as this bill?
Well, look, I think the bigger political problems for Democrats on the bill is that a lot of people are worried that it's accelerating. It would accelerate inflation.
Yes.
In fact, you look at the CBO score, you look at the details. I mean, they basically, you know, are assuming there's only going to be a handful of years of spending for the goodies, and they're not calculating the likelihood it's going to pass. A lot of these entitlements and these programs are going to be extended indefinitely, creating a huge tax burden and a huge weight on the deficit. There was actually a Politico poll that came out this morning showing a plurality of voters worried about they're worried that this is going to increase inflation. The Build Back Better bill will increase inflation. I think only about 12% said believe the Biden administration's spin that this was actually designed to reduce inflation. So that's the big, I mean, that's the number one issue for voters right now. They're going to the pump, they're buying groceries, they're going on Amazon buying goods, and they're seeing the prices go up pretty significantly. And that is the biggest concern for voters, and the risk that this White House faces is they seem totally unconcerned with the biggest issue on the minds of Americans right now.
Not only unconcerned, indifferent. It is the worst thing in America to be seen and to be in office and to be indifferent to the woes of working people. And that's Joe Biden and Nancy Pelosi. Maybe it's worse to give yourself $200 million for your neighborhood park. That's probably the worst bit of politics I've ever seen from the alleged political genius, and the speaker's chair is going to lose the speakership twice. Josh Kraushaar, happy Thanksgiving to you. I want to close the show today by asking everyone to pray for everyone involved in the Wisconsin horror, to redeem the morning by being generous at HughHewitt.com to children whose mom or dad is in jail. In a way, we will tell you about fundraising efforts to help those in Wisconsin when they are legitimate and verified. Pray for them now. Worry about children who are taken care of by Prison Fellowship. Thank you, Adam and Ben. Thank you, Generalissimo. Thanks, all of you out there. I will be back tomorrow. Prayers for you folks in Wisconsin. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Talk to you tomorrow.